16th school committee meeting. We're beginning what at 7:02. I'm going to do a quick run through the agenda, and then we will be taking a vote to enter executive session, and then we'll return and finish out the rest of our agenda. So the evening's agenda has executive session, like I just stated, the Pledge of Allegiance, then we'll do recognitions, our first public comment, reports to the school committee, and we will be having the art department, the music department, our liaison reports, our school committee report, and our superintendent report, and then we'll move on to new business, where we'll be discussing the school improvement plans for all five buildings. We'll discuss the middle school student and parent handbook changes, the high school travel, intent to travel, capital project article. Then we'll move on to the awards of contracts for high school one-to-one laptops, award of students information systems contract, request to expend year-end balances, the awarding of the high school middle school telescopic bleachers contract, the award of the asphalt patch and berm repairs contract, and then a vote to ratify the MOU with the custodians. We'll have no old business this evening, our second opportunity for public comment, and then our items by consensus. And at this time, I would seek a motion to enter executive session in order to ratify the memorandum of understanding with the custodians local 335.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, and we need a roll call vote. Mr. Graziano?
Yes.
Ms. Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Ms. Birchman?
Yes.
And I'm a yes as well, so we are now entering into executive session. For the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, Dr. McLeod, when you're ready, recognitions.
So good evening. It is my pleasure this evening to begin by inviting Paul DeBona. If you would come up, Paul. I have a presentation for you, but I also, you can sit right here, we'll both pretend you're not well. I was driving to Center School, or actually I was leaving Center School one day, about a month ago, and I came out and there was, I've learned tonight that you are Mr. Paul, so may I call you that? Is that okay?
Absolutely.
There was Mr. Paul, safely guiding the children and the adults and organizing the cars, and what struck me was, well, there were a couple things, but first of all was the incredible organization that I felt in the front of the school in a place where it had been really very disorganized, and I know Principal DeBow had been very concerned about that. We had used staff to try to organize the crossing walks. But you have a way of just reassuring everybody, and people are most excited about being in your hands, including myself when I'm trying to get across the street. When I first got here as superintendent, I was extremely concerned about the safety in front of the high school. And we worked together with the school committee and the police department to try to find somebody who could help us not only organize, but maintain some safety. There was an issue at the end of the second year where we were trying to figure something out, and for a couple of days we asked you to stand aside.
Yes.
And we asked Mr. Paul, could you just stand over here because we've been asked to evaluate what would happen if you're not there. Well, we had a lot of people who were very upset with us because they were, what are you doing and why are you letting him do what he does so well? So I just really wanted to take the opportunity tonight to recognize you, to thank you. You are out there in all kinds of weather with a smile on your face, and I watched the high school students, very, very respectful of you, waiting for their turn. Nobody's honking horns. Everybody's just like, okay, he's got this under control and we're all safe. But the one thing I did worry about, and I was trying to think, how can I recognize Mr. Paul, is that I worry that you don't stand out enough. So I thought if you were wearing this bright orange hat, you know, in addition to your yellow vest, that there's no way we wouldn't want anything to happen to you.
Thank you very much.
So I want to thank you very much, but I also have some very special friends here.
Oh.
And I think it's one thing for me to recognize you, but boys and girls, if you would just come up now, please, all of you. Come on up. This is your chance to be on television. Mrs. DeBoe, why don't you come on up too?
Okay.
Yep. And moms and dads, come on up. We want them to be comfortable. Because I know you have some.
Oh, look it. There's room for both of you.
So we have some center school students, some former center school students,
oh, cool.
And some that when they attended center school, we did not have the benefit of Mr. Paul. And we have parents who are very thankful that we now have Mr. Paul to guide us safely to and each side of the street back and forth safely. Some of our friends have some things for you. Mm-hmm. Molly, would you like to introduce yourself and share that with Mr. Paul?
I'm Molly Flannery, and I made you a card.
Oh, thank you, Molly. That's sweet. Thank you to Mr. Paul.
And Molly, before, when I was talking to you, what did you tell me about Mr. Paul, why you think he's special?
Because he keeps everybody safe.
That's right.
Thank
he
you.
He does keep everybody
thank
safe.
Thank you, Molly.
Joshua, would you like to say a few words?
Okay. They're just here in support of you. It's a little, this is our first television experience. It's bright.
Mine.
Oh
the lights are intimidating.
The bright lights. Okay, Mrs. But Vaughn, Mom will speak.
As a parent, I have three children in actually all three of the elementary schools, Hopkins, Center, and Elmwood, and I do drop off and pick up. And I see you every day at Hopkins as I'm making that turn into the driveway and then having to make the turn out of the driveway at pickup time onto 85 can be very tricky. If you were not there, it would be very difficult for me to kind of navigate that and get to Elmwood so I can get my Elmwood child. But then I leave Elmwood and then I get to center school
and
we see you at center school. So we're very appreciative. When my oldest, and actually when she was at center school, we did not have you there. And so we definitely appreciate your presence there and know that
thank
we're
you.
Safer and the children are safer. So thank
I'm
you.
I'm frightened that you're going to ask me to go to Elmwood too.
No, I would fight to keep you, Mr. Paul.
Thank you.
So,
it's very nice. Thanks, guys. This will match my 300th anniversary volunteer.
That's right.
There you
but that's much brighter. So
yes.
That's
yeah, I'll be looking for it.
All right.
Thank
okay.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're quite comfortable. Maybe someday you will be on that side over there.
Thank you, Ms. DeBoe. Thank you so much. Next, we have Christine Brown. If you could take a seat up here. And I know that Deb Arianti was not able to be here tonight, but I'm going to turn it over to you in just a minute. But before I do, I wanted to point out the reason you're here tonight. Is because the Hopkinton Middle School will be one of the first middle schools in Massachusetts to develop a program specifically addressing the needs of students re-entering school after absences due to serious mental health problems or medical illness. Christine and Deb wrote a grant. You know that we have a START program in the high school. The middle school's transition program will be open at the start of 16-17, and Principal Keller is excited about having the resources allowing the school to be a pioneering middle school in making a difference for a group of students who need supports that we haven't been able to provide in the past. I thought that the school committee and the community would enjoy hearing from a parent of a high school student who participated in the program this year. Dear Dr. McLeod, I received this on June the 5th.
I'm writing you today to provide feedback on the START program that has been implemented at Hopkinton High School to assist students for life-impacting events, including post-concussion support. And he goes on to talk about that they feel so fortunate that the high school has received the START grant and that our family could be one of the first benefactors. The team approach from the associates below were critical to helping get their son the support that he needed. Their son and family benefited tremendously by the START program. We feel so fortunate that this was the first year of the Hopkinton High School's three-year grant and that we were able to take advantage of the services. In conversations with medical professionals and other parents outside of school, we've also gotten positive feedback on how unique this program is and how lucky we were to have had this support. We're happy to report that after several weeks, their son was fully caught up academically. He even made the honor roll. More importantly, he received some life skills to know how to advocate for himself, how to negotiate with teachers and coaches, and how to juggle competing priorities to keep his grades high. And I was so touched when I read this, and then at the same time, very shortly, you were awarded the grant. I didn't realize that you were one of the only middle schools in the state. And I just thank you. I know that we've been talking about this for a while, mm-hmm. and that you've put a lot of time and energy, and you've been working closely with the high school. So we want to recognize you and Deb and everybody that was involved and give you the chance. I don't know if you have anything you'd like to add.
Other than we're so excited to have this program at the middle school. It's something that we've talked about actually for a couple of years of just how do we service our students who have extended absences due to psychiatric or medical illness and help them bridge the gap between their absence and getting back into a classroom in a way that is supportive, that has allowed them going to be successful. And once we heard about the model that was happening in Brookline, the Bright model, and then the high school got their program and met with such success, we really felt that this was going to be a good match for the middle school. And in doing all of our research for the grant this year, we actually identified close to 15 students at the middle school who would have benefited greatly from this program. So we're really looking forward to getting it up and running in the fall.
And how much was it, Christine?
I believe about $220,000 over 3 years to begin this program. And it provides money for a clinician to come in and work. And then the program will also provide a teaching assistant to provide academic assistance to students.
And as you know, we're gathering data on the success of the program, because the whole idea is that if we can show that evidence, that then we would maintain it on our own. That's the expectation of the grantees. And it certainly seems to be having that impact. And it seems also to be very flexible.
Yes.
Kids can be in and out and getting support for a variety of needs that maybe we didn't even anticipate. So
exactly.
Thank you so much. I'm very excited that we're going to be able to offer this at the middle school. And we wouldn't be able to unless someone took the time to write the grant.
Exactly. And I look forward to coming back in a year and telling you how great.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Is that it?
Yep.
Okay. And so we've come to our first opportunity for public comment. Is there anyone here for public comment? No? Okay. All right. Then we can move on to reports to the school committee. Our first report is the art department update from Colleen Giannino. Did I say that right?
Yes, good evening. Thank you for having me here. So yes, Colleen Giannino, the visual arts subject matter leader for the district. As a whole, we've had a really productive and successful year. I first wanted to recognize Karen Lucy from Center School, who's our new first grade art teacher this year, and she's been a really great addition to our team. We launched several new grants this year at the high school and at Hopkins. We kicked off the year at the high school with the Enhancing the Digital Art Curriculum through Interactive Experiences, which was a Hopkinton Education Foundation grant. Kelly DeRosa at Hopkins School and her students finally began experiencing the Glass Fusion grant, and she also helped kickstart the new makerspace with technology and library. At the high school, photography teacher Sterling Worrell put his Canvas grant to work on his smartphone photography course, which was extremely successful. He presented at MassQ in the fall about this, and he also took three of his students with him to the Learn Launch Across Boundaries EdTech Conference at the Harvard Business School, and they spoke, the three students spoke about classrooms of the future, and they spoke about this smartphone photography course. That was Anna Ali, Caitlin O'Connor, and Emily Taylor. In addition to this, we've had so many students recognized throughout the winter and spring for several accomplishments. In January, we had 5 gold keys awarded for the Boston Globe Scholastic Art Awards, 8 silver keys, and 20 honorable mentions, and that was both for high school and middle school. Students' work and names are all listed on the art department website. So you can see those there. High school senior and international student Renata Kobayashi was recognized by the Hopkinton Organizing Prevention Coalition for her logo design. They sponsored a contest, and she won the award for that contest. In March, we had 15 juniors and seniors participate in our annual Honors Art Exhibition. It was the first time we were in the new Hopkinton Center for the Arts, the newly renovated space. So that was curated by Chris Kellenberger, and the students there were Bridget Stafford, Jillian Kellett, Sadie Morgan, Sasha Hagen, Meg Bradbury, Emma Wright, Annie Dumas, Victoria Fang, Alyssa Mitchell, Isabel Holden, Erica Stefano, Hannah Welsh, Michaela Cosa, Kendall Hoyt, and Haley Wigington. It was a very successful evening. In April, our senior Chrysanthi Barris had 2 pieces of work published in the Marble Collection, and that's a statewide magazine for the arts, and students take on that initiative themselves to submit work. So that's really a big surprise to find out. It's our second year in a row that we've had students participate in that. So I anticipate we'll have more students kind of do that. Just last weekend, juniors Sarah Lincoln and Lauren Ness attended the Art All-State event, which is sponsored by the HPTA for us. So they are selected by a group across the state to attend this great event. Junior Sasha Hagen won the 4th Congressional District High School Art Competition in Photography for the 3rd year in a row. And in May, we had another successful Night for the Arts, an annual all-school art show. It was the 2nd year in a row. We featured student work from all grades in the district, and we plan on continuing that. It's a great success. And I just wanted to thank teacher Valerie Von Rosenvink and Isaac Brody for sharing the evening with us. Our 11th edition of Hop Arts magazine was also released that evening, and that is another piece that was sponsored by the HPTA for us. It was curated by Ryan Mueller of Metro Pictures Gallery in New York City, so we were really fortunate to get some really great jurors on that. 3 principal awards were granted that evening to Lauren Ness, Alyssa Mitchell, and Brittany Power. And most recently, high school teacher Christine Enos was awarded an HEF grant, co-authored by Doug Scott, the Tech Engineering SML, and myself, for the new FabLab 3D Design and Fabrication course that's going to take place this coming school year. And we're really excited. We're starting to order our equipment and planning our projects. So that's it. We have hopefully another great year ahead. In closing, I just want to recognize all the members of my team. They work really hard and dedicate their time to their students, both elementary all the way up to high school. I'd like to thank all of you, the district, and our fabulous administrative team, and all the community members and organizations, the PTA, the Hopkinton Ed Foundation, and the HCA, because without all of you, we wouldn't be able to be who we are. So thank you.
Well, Colleen, thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm sitting here listening to you, and you're not taking any credit, but I know that it just so happens that the 2nd year of that district-wide grade-level art show, it also happens to be your 2nd year as the SML, and you've just brought some great ideas, some great energy to your department.
Thank you.
Your enthusiasm. I know that Colleen has been part of the elementary building project, and we've really always, Ms. DeBoe and I have always been anxious if you're not there because, you know, this color scheme is very, very important.
That was one of the highlights of my year, I have to say. I was like, I'm liking this too much.
Just thank you.
Thank you
for everything that you've done and the leadership that you've provided your department and the opportunities that you've provided for students.
Thanks.
I know that that Carol was very impressed with her first. We couldn't pull her away from her first night in May when you came to visit.
I'm glad you came. Thank you for coming.
It was wonderful.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And now we're going to have the music department update and Mr. Craig Hay.
Good evening.
Good evening.
The music department has shown tremendous growth this year in a positive direction. The department has worked hard to continue development of our new standards, benchmarks, and district-determined measures in order to analyze our teaching practices and track student understanding. While this is an ongoing process, the music department has established a foundation on which to grow. We have, as a department, established a list of formative assessments that we can now share and modify K through 12. We've seen many positive gains in our general music classes and our performance ensembles over the last couple years, and we've done this while preparing for 34 separate performances this year. I would like to mention our new teacher, Jessica Barkin at Hopkins. She's had a tremendous year this year, really positive influence. We've seen both choruses grow tremendously this year. And we started this year with a new fourth grade chorus model where every fourth grader gets a trimester of chorus so that they can make a better decision going forward if they want to continue with chorus or try band or orchestra or do both. We've had a lot of success in various performances outside of the school district. The middle school bands, orchestra, or the eighth grade band, orchestra, and chorus all did very well at MICA this year. The high school groups all achieved silver or gold. And for district this year, at the junior level, we had 16 middle school students gain acceptance. We had 12 high school students at the senior level, six of which received all-state recommendations. One made it to all-state, Bella Comadromos. And she has gone above and beyond, where she received a recommendation to perform in the All-Eastern Chorus. And above that, she was recently accepted to perform in the National High School Chorus. So our first sort of All-American.
Yeah.
We've had some wonderful performances this year at MICA. The high school concert band received a gold medal and was able to perform at Symphony Hall. Our honors women's a cappella group, Noteworthy, they received a gold medal at the MICA Solo and Small Ensemble, and they performed in their gold medal showcase, which was also Pops and Prom weekend. One of the things that was really, I found this year with the students performing at Symphony Hall is how it moved some of the kids. And one of the students, Elise Miller, wrote a small reflection on her experience at Symphony Hall. So I'd like to read a little bit of that. By our concert in March, we sounded pretty good, but there was still a lot of work to do. March was spent adding feeling to the pieces, transforming it from a song to a story. We performed at MICA on April 1st and won a gold medal. I was so proud to be part of such an amazing group. And we were all proud of our accomplishment. I spent the weekend in the glow of victory, only imagining of where we could go from there. That Monday, Mr. Hay sent an email to us to say that we were selected to play at Symphony Hall. This was almost as exciting as when we got my dog. On April 16th, our moment came. We all had nervous energy, but a determination to rock the stage as much as a high school band could. The actual performance was a blur. I remember the last note of our first song, Metro Dance, rang for what seemed like an unnatural amount of time. Playing at Symphony Hall was thrilling beyond belief, and I consider it my proudest achievement with the group.
Wow.
And that was Elise Miller, who's a freshman. And I just want to finish up. I want to thank the Hopkinton Music Association and Clarinda Kershey, the president, for their continued support with our concert attire, preparing the concert booklet, and fundraising for our senior and lesson scholarships. This year, scholarships were awarded to Olivia Handerhan, Matthew Heim, and Jack McAuliffe. I would also like to thank the Hopkinton Parent Teachers Association for their generous donation this year that allowed us to go see the Boston Symphony Orchestra perform. And we were lucky enough to see Hopkinton resident Stephen Ansell perform a solo. I would like to thank publicly again the David French Music Company for loaning us even more cellos for us to use for the school year. And this has enabled more students to continue on the instrument of their choice. And finally, another thank you to David French. They sponsored a professional development for our middle school teachers this year on instrument repair, things that we can do in-house to save the district money and turn the instruments back over to the kids so that they can continue to perform. In conclusion, the music department myself could not do what we do without the support of the school committee, Dr. McLeod, Dr. Kavanaugh, and the whole administrative team. We are very grateful for your continued support of both performing and visual arts. Without your support, we would not have such a vibrant art and music program. Thank you.
So Craig, I'll echo some of my comments. You are also, believe it or not, only in your second year as the SML. And the things that you call out, like the fourth grade model, the new fourth grade model that you've been working on with the principal there to provide access for more kids. One of the things you and I worked on our first year was just the cellos on the bus saga. Mm-hmm. and how you found such a creative solution so that more kids could have access to that instrument at no cost to the district. Your leadership of your teachers and the support that you give to make sure that they get credit for all of the wonderful things that they do. 34 performances, I think, I can't even imagine that many in any other district I've ever heard of. And I just cannot end without commenting that the last thing that one would expect to hear at the beginning of an overview of the music department is district determined measures, correct? So that is just so impressive, and I think I have to speak to the school committee to say that this is something that the district has embraced across content area, and you know you've heard me speak before to say that the music and the art department are not extracurricular. These are central courses that are important for kids to have access to, and we know the positive benefits of both of those areas. And when you talk about formative assessments and district determined measures, I just think that's just another reminder of what an integral part of the program that we offer our students, both the music and art department, are. So thank you both for being here tonight and for everything that you do.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And congratulations.
Thank you.
So Dr. McLeod, I believe we're removing from the agenda tonight the Alternative Structured Learning Day proposal.
Yes.
Because that was, the proposal was rescinded.
That's correct.
Okay. So we can move on to liaison reports.
I can go first if you're
sure.
I met for the first time with the Irvine Todaro group, and I have not yet been sworn on to the committee. I'm waiting for the selectman's official appointment. But we worked on the survey for the residents that will go out later this summer on priorities for the property, including parking lot for the bus is one selection for people to look at, and also potential other school uses in the future.
And I do know that you are, the information has been submitted, and you are,
yes,
on the next Board of Selectmen's
Tuesday
meeting. Okay, so you are in place to get official.
That's great.
All right.
Nothing really from the Elementary School Building Committee other than we apparently have a meeting on Tuesday, this Tuesday night at 6:30. And honestly, the invitation came out today, so I don't
right
necessarily know what it's about.
Right.
But that is the next meeting of the ESBC.
And then Lauren and I have a meeting with the working group next week as well. A 4-hour afternoon group. We're going to be looking at safety, which was something that we hadn't had, mm-hmm, a chance to do. So we have two working group meetings scheduled between next week and the week after. And that should finalize all of those. Oh, and we have an address. Do you remember what it is? I think it's 129. 129 Hayden Row.
129 Hayden Row. There you go.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
That is exciting. We don't have to say the wood pile.
No. Except no one knows where 129 is.
Unless you get a street sign up there, I think we're going to.
We thought the construction workers needed to know where to go.
Mailbox.
There is an address.
They'll put a mailbox there.
I don't have a liaison report for the CPAC at this point, except that we do have a meeting next Tuesday at 7 o'clock, also in the middle school library. So likely our next meeting, I'll have a report for that. Anybody else? No? All right, so we can move on to the school committee chair report. Before we get into the minutes update, which there's information in your packet, and I'll go over a little bit of what I was thinking with some of the information we put in here. I did just want to address that, you know, we've had a number of emails over the past couple weeks, and just to let you know what's being responded to. Obviously, we had a public records request, and Dr. McLeod and I are working on that. There also was a request from Carolyn Dykema's office for us to respond to the Senate amendment regarding teacher evaluation ratings, and
teacher,
I know you, Dr.
McLeod, impact rating on teacher evaluation, and Lori and I, do you mind if I add in?
No, absolutely.
We had a discussion on this earlier in the week, and then just today I was able to respond on behalf of the school committee, because I had a really nice summary from MASS in terms of a position statement and how they want us to reach out to our senators to get to have some support. But in a nutshell, the idea is that district determined measures in and of themselves can be very useful if we can use them in a way that can help us with goal setting or improvement plans. But the fact that it has been suggested that they use to judge impact on student learning as part of the evaluation system is the part that is backfiring. And it's causing a lot of anxiety and a lot of stress, and it's preventing us from really being able to use the data in the way in which we'd like to be able to use it. So superintendents have been together in terms of our belief in as far as what would be useful, and we have provided a position statement that I then did share in response to that letter.
Right.
Okay.
Did anyone have any questions about that? From the conversation that Dr. McLeod and I had, it felt as if she would have much more information and expertise in responding to that than our group would. So I took her advice on that, and we went with that mission statement. So just wanted to make sure everyone was aware that the emails that we're receiving are getting responded to. The other issue that I believe was only sent to me and Dr. McLeod, as well as the Board of Selectmen, was there was a community member who was concerned over the building and grounds conditions, specifically at the high school and the middle school. We did respond, and we discussed the fact that, you know, we've added a position in the budget for next year, and that we were aware that, you know, the outside grounds have somewhat taken a back seat to the inside of the buildings, which were in need of repair and needing the focus and priority over the past couple of years. And we have not heard anything back from that citizen, I don't think. But
so I think he just replied to me to say thank you. Okay. I look forward to seeing the improvements in the coming months.
So we did respond there. And then the last thing I just wanted to bring to everyone's attention, if you didn't notice, is that there was a legal alert that came from the Massachusetts Association for School Committee members in regards to new policy that is needed for the district before school starts on prevention of drug and alcohol use in schools. And so we'll be looking and taking that up with some of our policies this summer. So I just wanted you to be aware that that'll be on our agenda in the coming 2 months or two. Yep. Meetings we have. So those are all the housekeeping updates. In terms of the minutes update, I wanted to have a group discussion because of the fact that there are some items on here that I think there were prior decisions made by prior chairs on how they were going to address minutes. So I wanted to go through what we consider to be the outstanding minutes, also to give John an opportunity to discuss where we are in some of these minutes, and then basically our plan for going forward to have us up to date. So what I provided in the packet, which was a small spreadsheet that Janine helped out with, And the first issue that I wanted to discuss was the fact that all of these meetings where we had joint meetings with the Board of Selectmen, it had been the decision of Ellen that these particular meetings were not requiring minutes because of how the meeting law is written. And in going back and reviewing the meeting law, which I did include in your packet, there are certain quote-unquote meetings that don't count as legal meetings requiring minutes. And those types of meetings would include those meetings where we're not making any kind of decision, or we're not taking a vote, or we're not really having a group discussion between ourselves on a matter. And so the list of items that are in the packet on, you know, the dates of the budget recommendation on 2/24/15, the budget working session on 3/4/15, the 3/17 update on capital articles, those three specifically, we're going to skip the 4/7/1, and then the November 3rd, 2015 budget policy statement, the December 1st, 2015 discussion of the FY17 proposed capital projects, and the 3/1/16 discussion of FY17 budget. Those six meetings, because there was no action taken by the school committee and no group discussion during those meetings to take an action, do not require minutes. And because it had been Ellen's decision at the time not to do minutes, it's really unfair to have us go back and try and recreate the wheel on those particular meetings. So if we were of the decision that we wanted minutes for those meetings. So those six meetings will have no minutes. The meeting on 4/7/15, we did take a vote. We took a vote to approve the center school building option, what our preferred option was as a committee. That meeting will have minutes to say who was present, what the motion was, what the vote was. And those minutes, I don't know if those
were submitted today.
They were submitted today.
Yep.
But what I wanted to discuss, because this is what I put in for discussion purposes, and you might have saw this in your packet wondering why is this old set of minutes in there. What I wanted to discuss was that on a go-forward basis, how do we as a committee want to deal with those meetings where there aren't maybe discussions or decisions taken, but we're all in attendance. And my reasoning behind this is that when we get public record requests, the public at large is not going and looking, generally speaking, at the open meeting law requirements and what constitutes a meeting, evaluating whether or not we really had a meeting or not. And I think that for simplicity and also from transparency point of view, my comfort level would be having minutes, even short and sweet, like these here, for those types of meetings, because I think it's much easier to hand over that as a public records request than it is to go through the legal arguments of why we're not doing minutes. And so I wanted to put that out there for discussion as a group. That's my opinion on it, and I wanted to put it out there now because obviously Nancy, as of this meeting, is taking over minutes, and I wanted us to have a clear understanding of where everyone thought on that and what we're going to do going forward so that we're actually taking minutes at those meetings and being able to confirm what's happened. So I definitely give you all an opportunity to speak on it. I just wanted to give you my thoughts and why this was included.
So I'm decidedly indifferent on this particular topic, but the only thing I will say is that it seems like we have enough of these types of meetings throughout the year that there is work involved in putting these minutes together, and I wonder if a more expedient solution might be looking at our meeting policy and amending the meeting policy to include when we do and do not provide minutes. I understand that in the case of a public records request that there may be some challenges related to that, but I think we could point to the policy and knock on wood, we haven't had, that hasn't been a frequent occurrence. And so it just seems like, you know, if you go through the list of the number of these meetings we have, it just seems like it's work for Nancy, it's work for Janine, it's where, so it's, that's the only reason that I guess I slightly question the work for value. But I'm not passionate about it.
So the only thing I want to respond to that is that I went looking for a meetings policy and couldn't find it.
I am actually passionate about that. I think it's less trouble to take these very short, I mean, it's basically a template of minutes to keep as a record on our website than to go back and forth with people to point them to a policy, which it sounds like maybe we even have to draft. And, you know, it's just easier for people to click and see this and have their question answered than have them have to go through those ensuing steps with us. In addition, not that this has happened, but, you know, there are requirements around attendance at meetings for all elected officials, and as a matter of record keeping and, you know, keeping track of people who are and are not attending minutes. And I don't remember ever that there was a problem, but were there to be a problem going forward with any elected official on any board not attending meetings that they're expected to attend, there's, you know, it's in the charter, the number of meetings that you can or cannot miss. I think from a record keeping standpoint, I just think this is actually much quicker and simpler.
I would agree with that, and to add that I think it's important that to have these up on the website so that people can go in and click as close to when the meeting took place as we're reasonably able to get up. I think if we don't put them up, it looks like there's a level of transparency, even though it's just simple to say that who was here and who was not here. People can go and look and see this is what we have.
Okay.
So just one clarification. We definitely have a school committee meeting policy. We redid it two years ago. Because that's when we changed the regular and special meeting. So
couldn't find it.
Because that's when we stopped calling them working sessions and called them special. I remember that. Remember we made that change?
Right, but we would have to amend it.
We'd have to amend it. But as I said, so I'm clearly in the minority here, so I think we've got our decision.
Okay. So, great. So on a go-forward basis, so what I do still want to clarify is that we are not reinventing the wheel with those six meetings. Those meetings, from a legal standpoint, do not require minutes. Is it a gap per se? Yes, but it was that decision at that time. So at this time, I consider those six meetings taken care of and they're no longer outstanding. And the 4-7 meeting, like you said, has been submitted, so we'll see that in an upcoming meeting to review the minutes for. It wasn't in this one, right?
No, it's not in this one.
Okay.
It was submitted today.
Okay. So now we can jump down to the rest of the minutes that are on this list. And it does bring up another issue that I wanted to discuss because of the fact that I have multiple lists here, which thank God Kim Big came back in my folder because I was going to panic. So the summer special meeting on July 9th, just take attention to that one, as well as the November 19th meeting from 2015, and then
we're good on February 4th.
February 4th.
We're okay.
We're good?
Yeah.
Okay. So
however, I mean, it fits into the category. I just had that in notes.
What about the 12/22 one?
No, that's fine.
Okay. So just those first two, I'm sorry, the July 9th, 2015, and 11/19. There appears to be no recording for either of those meetings. So my recommendation, which there's obviously then difficulty in doing minutes for those meetings, but my recommendation for those meetings is that the school committees that were present for those meetings look back into their notes to see what we have to try and recreate minutes. Mm-hmm. I know I often keep notes on motions and who made motions, and so that's my request at this point, and I'll make the same request to Kelly. And I may also reach back out to Ellen just to see if she has notes on those two meetings. As for all of the other meetings, John, I'll have you give an update on either whether they've been submitted.
But those two has been submitted at this point.
Okay, so other than those two meetings, everything has been submitted, and we'll soon be reviewing them in our next meeting.
Yeah. So the one note, so I will point out too, so 11/19, I have notes that are less effective than I'd like them to be. 2-4 was also, there was no recording, but I learned from 11-19, so the notes for that were solid enough that I feel comfortable with those minutes.
Right.
But when they do come through, it might be worth taking a longer look at February 4th just to make sure that there isn't any gap in those, because again, they're based on my notes.
Which you're now reminding me of what my second point was of discussion that I wanted to bring up, was the fact that, so we've had a couple instances over this past year where HCAM's recording didn't work for some reason while we were in the middle school library. We're not aware, obviously, while we're on TV of whether or not it's working. My suggestion, I don't know if it's the best suggestion, I'm certainly welcome to other ideas from a technological standpoint, is that we start dual recording the meetings mm-hmm. with the tape recorder, because I think it's unfair to expect everyone to remember everything that happens in all our meetings along with everything you have going on in your daily lives, on top of the fact that, you know, we have that responsibility to provide clear meeting minutes. And so I want to make sure that we have some kind of backup plan, and it's not a ding on HCAM. They've been wonderful to us, but things happen and we can't tell at the time. So, you know, we weren't either taking great notes or whatever happened on those particular days. We were dependent on technology that doesn't always work. So that's my recommendation. But if other people have other ideas of how we want to deal with this problem, I'm certainly open to ideas for that.
So I like the idea of dual recording. I know that even as I was taking, as I would take more detailed notes, it's difficult sometimes to take notes and be a present in person in the meeting. So I think the dual recorder would be good. We have the little mini recorder, right?
We do. I think that what we need to do, however, is I'll add to something I'll ask Janine to check in on, which is at the end of each meeting, make sure the recording, find out if the recording in fact did not work, and then immediately retrieve the recording, because by the time we went back into this, into the folders to find out where those meetings were, it's impossible to find.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I think it'll be a great backup only if we remember to check the next morning with HCAM, and if there was an issue, we would have it right away, mm-hmm. and right there. So I'll add that on my notes.
Okay, great.
Can I add one?
Absolutely.
So so in talking about the meetings that don't have minutes associated with them, we did, as you recall, take a vote at day two of town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So day two of town meeting had minutes that will be submitted, because we did conduct business to take a vote around the amended motion.
Right, we did.
So.
In researching the laws on the meetings we had gone to where we didn't take action, we realized that meeting should have had minutes as well. And so we're adding that to the list. And they were submitted, you said?
Yeah.
Okay.
What was the date of that one, John? 5/5, 5/6?
No,
it was
5/2.
5/2.
I think day two.
5/2. May 2nd.
5/3. May 1st. Wait, was a Sunday. May 1st was a Sunday.
Yeah.
Oh, you're right. Okay so 5/3.
5/3.
Whatever the Tuesday, the first Tuesday in May.
Got it.
I think we had our recess forum on May 10th, which is not on this list.
It's been
publicly
submitted.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
that one.
That's all right. Okay. Yeah. I didn't see it on this list.
And we also submitted for the Hopkins principals.
Yeah, which is not on the list yet.
And the assistant superintendent position.
That
so those
here.
Have been.
Janine's got to have so much waiting for her when she gets back from vacation.
Well, that's why I'm writing down the dates. So
I think I forgot to CC you all forward it.
Thank you. Okay, so we're going to say the, you said the Hopkins and the Elmwood?
Yeah, Elmwood's on the list already.
Elmwood was already there.
Hopkins. Okay.
Actually, Elmwood, I think, is in our packet.
Right, you're right. Elmwood's done. That's the assistant. Yep.
Okay. Got it.
Did you have anything else, Jane?
I do have one more question. And are we going to also get caught up on all our executive session minutes? We don't have a lot, but we...
Well, we do usually do that...
July.
Is it? Oh, we're going to do it in July?
I thought we usually did it before the changeover, which has happened. So...
Right, would you like to do it in the July 7th meeting, which is our last regular?
I'm not going to be here.
So at our earliest committee, this point, it's a change of the committee anyways, but I just wouldn't even get...
Going forward, it would be nice to do it before the changeover.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. It was on our executive session agenda several times this year, but then we just had so many other things to discuss that we went over on our time.
We did do it in November.
Right.
We started.
We were supposed to do it again, I think, in April,
and we didn't get through many.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Can I, I don't know if Janine has that, what the outstanding list is on executive session minutes.
Yes.
That would be great, just so I can kind of follow along with that.
Okay.
Anything else on minutes? Was
there sometimes seems like there's a gap between what is up on our website and what appears to have been approved. Is there something that we can do to?
Yeah, that's
that
needs to
bit?
Be taken care of in my office, okay. And it will be.
Great. Anything else? I think as after our next meeting, when we get the rest of the minutes that were submitted, we should be very up to date with our regular and special meetings. The executive session we'll still have to work on. So,
thank you.
Great. The next thing on our agenda is the superintendent's report. Dr. McLeod.
Well, thank you. Our wonderful administrative team is here, and so welcome everybody. It's always so exciting when you are here. So the only thing that I will report tonight is that I am absolutely delighted to have Dr. Kavanaugh on board officially. She's only been here for a short couple of weeks, and already I just feel such a partnership. She's been out and met people and really feels part of the team. And so welcome. We're so glad you're here.
Thank you. I am thrilled to be here. So,
With that, I'll turn it back over to you, and I guess we're going to go in order. We only have one seat, so we'll bring them up one at a time tonight.
Okay. Mrs. DeBoe, if you would join us for first the preschool and then center school's school improvement plans.
Sure, thank you. This is quite a treat to have these chairs.
I know.
Next building meeting, I'm going to say, where are these chairs?
Well, and great. What are the size of the chairs that you spend your day in?
Actually, so this is an extra treat. Thank you. Thank you. So I have two school improvement plans to share with you. The first will be this preschool. Once we are under one roof, we will have one school improvement plan. But while we are in two separate locations, there are some things just for feasibility. It is separate at this point. However, you'll notice there are some commonalities and some connections along with Elmwood and Hopkins, which is terrific. So first, I'd like to introduce our preschool school council members. I am on the school council. Meredith Eckwell, the director of curriculum. Karen Jewett, who is with us for at least half of this year as BCBA. Kim Sullivan, preschool teacher. And then we have parents, Jody Baker, Sabine St. Pierre, Amy McDonald, and Heather Marusa. Something you'll notice that we are in need of on our school councils is the community rep. So the HPTA helps coordinate these positions. So it is someone that does not have a child in the program. We had one on our center school, you'll see the previous year, but sometimes that's a position that's difficult to fill. So for those of you out there that are looking to be interested, we welcome you to join our school councils. We will have two goals this coming school year. Our first school improvement plan goal will focus on the incorporation of technology. This is exciting for preschool. We now have access to interactive technology. With the move from middle school to Elmwood, each preschool classroom now has an interactive whiteboard. This was not the case in our previous location. So now we need to learn how to use them and to incorporate them into our daily lessons. So our goal will focus on training and instituting a component of our curriculum that we have not been able to do so in the past. And this needs to be well thought out and planned so that it's purposeful technology and it's meaningful for children. When you're looking at young children and technology, it will never replace the teacher at our level, the markers in the hands, the pencils and the paints. However, it does have a role to reinforce and support learning, so we are excited to embark on this endeavor, because once we are in our new facilities, then we will already have this training behind us and be able to hit the ground running with that. Our second school improvement plan goal focuses on social-emotional learning. You'll see it abbreviated as SEL. The state has developed standards for preschool and kindergarten that target social-emotional learning areas as well as approaches to play. So our second goal focuses on a coordinated approach to meet student needs. The state has identified five areas for social-emotional learning, and when you hear them, they've been terms that we have used throughout other school improvement plan goals, through responsive classroom, and they are self-awareness, and for young children, it's identifying feelings and having an accurate self-perception of those feelings, which, you know, when your children are young, and for those of you that have young children, sometimes it's hard to identify those. Self-management, which is control, learning to manage impulses and to be motivated for different tasks. Social awareness, which is perspective. At this age, the world revolves around them, and developmentally, that's where they are. So building empathy for others and taking on other viewpoints is a bit of work. Relationship skills. Children will have disagreements at times. How do we manage those conflicts? How do we ask for help when we need help? These are things that we'll work on teaching our students. And responsible decision making. That is problem identification, and we do a lot of this. Sometimes it's hard for children to identify what the problem is. They know something's wrong, but getting to what is the problem can take some navigation and the facilitation of adults for that, as well as solving problems. So those are the state's five areas. We break it down in developmentally appropriate terms. For us to accomplish that, we will be benefiting from our assistant superintendent this summer, who will be teaching a course that many preschool and center school staff will be participating in. She is a trainer on an introductory course for the social emotional learning standards. So that's one of our first action steps for that. And we'll be inviting some other outside members of the Hockington Public Schools, but yet early childhood community, to participate in that as well. We know when we look at where we have come that we have much of this in place. Preschool is NAEYC accredited, which we go through 10 criterion, in-depth steps. So we know that we have social emotional as part of our program, but taking into account the standards, how much is it consistent across the grade level? Are we addressing all of those five areas, and what are the means to do so? So it's just providing it with a greater lens and consistency. When we look at our previous school improvement plan goal, where have we come? What are the updates with that? Our previous school improvement plan had three goal areas. The first was focused on maintaining NAEYC accreditation. So that stands for the National Association for the Education of Young Children. It's quite an endeavor. It is like NEASC for early childhood centers. So if you're ever going through a high school accreditation program, it's a multi-year, highly involved, self-evaluative, in-depth look at your program. So our goal was to maintain that. And why it was so important to maintain that, we moved locations. When you move a location, you need to submit a report to the accreditation department. I needed to show all of my transcripts that I was qualified to be the leader. With our previous special education director retiring, I am now listed as the director coordinator for the program. I needed to show that I was qualified. We needed to show square footage of the rooms at Elmwood, the square footage of the play areas, all of these detailed plans, similar to not quite the building project, but similar to show that the facilities were appropriate. We passed and maintained all of those move locations, as well as the submission of the annual report to maintain this. So that was in good standing, and when we developed our goal, we no longer need to have that as a school improvement plan goal. It is something that we will look at maintaining, something that we did pose to the school council and then through our administration team was how invested are we in this accreditation? Is it something that we continue to seek year after year? We have the accreditation. It's good, if you will, for 5 years. We renew it. When it comes to our anniversary, and that is how they term it, we need to embark on the process again. And given the time and effort to maintain this, we know we have a quality program, but there are tasks for this that will detract from our strategic plan. So we need to look at, in the past, when you had such accreditation, it facilitated grant funding, additional resources to your program. So we need to weigh out what is the time investment and what is our return for maintaining that accreditation. And of course, there's a fee, and it's a quite hefty fee involved in that.
Mrs. DuBois, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
So as you stated that because you moved from the middle school to Elmwood, that you had to seek basically re-accreditation or
just approval. Yes.
So God willing, that the new building is built on time, and I'm definitely...
It will be.
I'm definitely going for it. I have a personal investment in that, for sure. But will you have to do the same thing again?
We will. If that is before our fifth anniversary, the fifth anniversary may come about for the program before the move.
Oh, okay.
So this was the second submission for the annual report, so chances are it will be in sync with that time of the move for the resubmission. So that also adds to moving, right, relocating, building a program in terms of equipment that we didn't have the luxury of having space and storage, as well as going through this in-depth project. And it is quite a task. So we would need to, I am sure and confident that we would attain that. Something that really is a factor for me is the fees. And if we're not getting a lot back in grant funding or return for that, it's hard for me to justify the time spent on seeking and maintaining the accreditation.
So what are the benefits of the accreditation? I understand from other preschool standpoint that are not attached to public schools, it's highly sought after by parents. But your program, year after year, has to turn people away at this point. So obviously you're in a situation where the reputation precedes you. So I guess I wonder what would be your consideration on that?
So because we have a strong professional development system in the school, and we have a strategic plan to guide us with goals, and we are continually improving and measuring ourselves, are we meeting those goals? Where is it that we need to add more to align that goal? We have those in place. At times, private programs are looking for alignment, perhaps across chains, where it's difficult to ensure that consistency in multiple locations, or it's a smaller program, if you will, that does not have the benefits of the professional development that we have. Because we already have so much of that in place, being a public school, it's a hallmark of a quality program. So it is fabulous to have for all the programs that have it. It is something to truly be applauded because of the time and effort for that. But many of the opportunities that are for us to grow, we are doing regardless of that accreditation.
Right.
Where some other programs, it opens up the doors, especially those smaller programs and chains.
Thank you. I appreciate
yes.
it.
Thank you. It's a great question. Sometimes when you live it so much, it's you forget the explanation to accompany that. In our previous school improvement plan goal, we also had an aligned curriculum goal. This was, you've heard many conversations about unpacking the standards, looking at what we're doing in English language arts and in math, our curriculum teacher leaders identifying power standards from kindergarten to first grade to second grade, making sure we have alignment within a building and across buildings. This past year, preschool began unpacking the English language arts standards, looking at where our students are, where they're transitioning to kindergarten. That was begun for English language arts. It did not carry over to math. Other needs arose in preschool that needed greater attention. A challenge for us when you look at the standards, most of them in preschool are with support. So it's hard to identify power standards when most of them are part of what we teach children versus other grades. By the end of kindergarten, we would like children to know math facts 0 to 5. With preschool, most of it is with support and guidance because it's developmentally appropriate. So it's hard to identify power standards when they are with guidance and support. We will be continuing to look at that as we move forward to align our standards and looking at our science. Preschool will certainly work at science, and absolutely, and they do now. But other needs in terms of the move and transitioning, we felt that we were in a good place, and we did not unpack the math, if you will, for that. Our third goal was instructional assessment. There is a component of the preschool curriculum. They use the OWL curriculum, Opening Our World of Learning. It is a curriculum specific to preschool. In the past, the assessment area was not fully implemented. So this year, the teachers had a shared goal to use those assessments with their community partners, their peer pals, and provide that information on their progress reports. And that was looking at phonemic awareness skills, looking at, so it was developmentally appropriate assessments and checks, looking at letters, perhaps sounds, and then working on activities to reinforce them. And they developed take-home bags that were part of family activities and game-like items. So looking at those progress for the students over the course of the year, it has made an impact and has strengthened those early literacy skills, which feed into kindergarten foundational skills. But it doesn't mean teaching them reading. These are actually precursors to reading that then facilitate the reading. So they did, teachers successfully met that. A challenge was for me to find the set established times to make sure it happened to meet with the teachers to review the data. A challenge is separate locations and the timing of when things occur. So it has been shared with me, teachers have met, but something that I need to ensure happens is the conversations around the data. Where teachers are sharing the progress and what they've done, I like to be there to ask those questions. It's just part of my controlling. But I'm thankful that they were able to accomplish that. So looking next year, we have two goals. They're highly focused goals, the very meaningful goals, which is important to note. If the school improvement plan, while it aligns with the strategic plan, it needs to be meaningful for the level you're at. And these are highly meaningful goals for us. Do you have any questions?
So before that, Lauren, first of all, thank you. I wanted to acknowledge, before anybody continues, that all of you have done such a wonderful job at meeting the school committee's requests around the organization of the school improvement plans, from recognizing the participants right at the beginning to including the information on last year's goals. So I had asked the principals in coming here tonight to really focus their comments on this year's goals, because I know that you have access to the background information. But I also am just delighted to listen to all of you. And as you said, it tells a story. It tells a story of this district from preschool to 12th grade. And so I unless there's questions, we can move on to center.
So now we're growing up a little bit. Now we're talking about the kindergarten first grade building. And this year, we also did not have a community rep. We did in our previous year. So again, community members, feel free to join our school council. We'd love to have you. This year on our school council, I was on the school council, Janine Sheelan, Tim Sanford, who is a first grade teacher, Elena Chagnon, a kindergarten teacher, Meredith Beauregard, a kindergarten teacher, parent David Turner, Amanda Robichaux, Kristen Pedroli, and Kyla McSweeney. So we have some graduating parents. They're moving on to Elmwood, so they might in the future be on the Elmwood School Council. And it really is just wonderful to have parents part of this, because they bring so much to the councils. It is a great collaborative effort for us. This year, we have two goals at center, highly focused goals for us. Our first goal, it is to use the data that we've been working on collecting. We are doing a better job of assessing students, but it's not the heavy stakes, stressed out testing that you hear in the news and children are stressed. These are formative assessments and benchmark assessments. And it helps us know if we're doing our job. If we're teaching, we would like children to grow and make progress. If they're not, we need to adjust what we're doing so that that happens. So a goal this year is for teachers to take it to another level, and this is with guidance and support, to use instructional data to guide our adjustments, and specifically in the areas of English language arts and math. So improvements that we've made, our goal status, we have improved our fidelity, if you will, on our assessment implementations. A challenge is when a person is conducting an assessment or providing directions. You need to do it the same way he does, and she does, and she does. And sometimes that can be a challenge. So we have spent time revisiting directions, application. When we complete forms, how do we complete them? If there are further questions, why did you make this decision? Explain it to us. So it's not just collecting information, we're looking at information, we're analyzing information, and that is helping us inform our next instructional steps and that's facilitated consistency across the grade level and the school, and I feel like we're sending better assessment information onto Elmwood, which is then needed because it facilitates that smooth transition to know where students are. Something else that we've done this year on our report cards, our trimester report cards, we're sharing information with families on guided reading level. That was not done in the past. So it helps provide a check of not just in relation to our standard-based report card, but if you're going to the library, if you're reading with a child, what's an instructional level book in terms of meeting your child's needs? And explaining, working to explain more to families, what does that mean, instructional level? Because there's a variety of levels for students. Hard, instructional, independent. So we're trying to do a better job of sharing that with families. And as we look at these, we're talking about growth with students. Children come in, and we just completed our second day of kindergarten screening today at all different levels, and we recognize that. Just as children don't all walk at the same month, at the same time, reading develops differently. Our goals are high for all children, but we look at where they came from and where they are, valuing the growth and ensuring that every child is making growth. So I can say that every child has made growth. Sometimes it's at differing rates for children, but we're making growth and moving forward. And in terms of attaining our goals, we are doing a fabulous job of making sure children are the readers that will lead our town and our country someday. That they will. We have benchmarks to help and strategies to ensure that we meet these goals. It involves a time together with each other, and it's purposeful time. Professional learning community meetings, PLC, with guides, with focus. There are times that I join teachers here. There are times they meet with each other. Things that we're expanding next year is observations of other teachers. This year we had some of that. Looking at how can we have more of that happen, we need to schedule that for teachers. If you're looking to improve an aspect of math or reading instruction, we're going to provide a schedule. You can see someone who's doing it very well to take back so that you can borrow that idea and learn from your colleagues. We will support teachers in developing formats for how is it that we document our adjustments to practice. How is it that we expand that toolbox? We know a student needs more work in a particular area of reading. What are some ways to accomplish that? So I think we've worked well on building a sense of collaboration and trust with staff members. We are looking on improving our capacity for all teachers and educators to meet student needs. So these are things that will be a deeper level at adjustment to practice, so it is not the same goal as last year. We are making progress, and as we perfect this, it's going to look even more more intense, if you will, but intense in a good way, in a good way. Our second goal mirrors our preschool goal, the social emotional learning. While the state has identified standards for preschool and kindergarten, the state has guidelines for kindergarten through high school. And they make sense for first grade as well. Those same five areas that I talked about with preschool, we are looking at launching that coordinated approach. At center, something that we benefit from and will look to expand to share with preschool is having a team of staff comprised of the behavior analysts, the guidance counselors, the psychologists, and the teachers to help implement social emotional learning throughout the school. It can't come just from me. I need staff input on how is it we're going to approach this. It is not replacing responsive classroom. I liken it to an umbrella. Responsive classroom is a component. It has fabulous elements of it. We're looking for a unified approach across the building that uncovers all of these areas, where it might be a focus on a particular month on one of those five areas. So as a school, we are working on identifying feelings. Maybe there are some shared meetings. Maybe there are some role modeling or morning announcements that target that skill, and that's a highlight in every classroom. And when we work on something together, we typically have a greater return with our students. We did that earlier this year. We had to refocus on just respecting other adults, that if someone asks you to walk in the hall, if they're not your teacher, it's okay to listen to them and walk in the hall. And when we came together as a school to really address that and reinforce that, we had great results. So looking at how can we improve that with our social learning, involving a group to help make those decisions for what's meaningful for our children, what's realistic to implement in the classroom, because it's not a curriculum, it's an approach and guidelines. We will help shape what that looks like for our students. And you know, as adults, if we can get social emotional learning well established, we will have happy, healthy adults that are productive moving forward. And that's very important that it is. For updates for our previous goals, our goal on student achievement this past year focused really on the closing of the gap, and it was number based. So as we reflected this year and we looked at where that goal was, what were strengths and challenges, we need to look beyond the number target. It's great, we're moving kids forward, we have a high percentage for students at or above grade level, but we can't end there. We continually need to look at how to refine our instructional practices to meet needs, because next year we're going to have a new group of students in our classrooms, they're going to need different things, so we need to build that capacity to be able to do that. Our second goal last year was research-based practices and instruction, so it segued. Our first goal focused on growth, and our second growth last year focused on assessments and looking at data. So we've improved our fidelity, our consistent approach, we reviewed them. Now we're at the deeper analysis level, so not just looking at and scores and how children are performing, but looking at reading, error analysis. When a child makes an error, what does that mean? And there's a lot of work to be done there to make sure that our teachers are confident, have the skills and the resources. There's a lot to be had here, but making sure it's manageable. Sometimes there's too much, and it's almost like a menu. We need to pare it down, so here it is, and this is what would work for this particular child, this group, and sharing those resources. And our last goal, we did focus on responsive classroom last year. The HPTA was very helpful in helping fund Responsive Classroom 2, which was another level of responsive classroom training. As we implement social emotional learning, we will still maintain our responsive classroom approach, our morning meeting, some of that common language. But the social emotional learning goal was help direct what the school will focus on as a whole. So as we implemented and expanded our responsive classroom trained staff, we will continue to implement those practices throughout our buildings. Do you have any questions?
Go ahead, John.
So if I go back to the first goal, and this may, because adjustment to practice is something we talk about more broadly, so this may be a question for both ends of the table. I guess when as I look at this, what I always wonder about is how do we really measure adjustment to practice? So even in the wording in here is, I think, what sort of tipped this question is, all teachers will use observation, feedback, and benchmark assessment data to adjust instructional practices. But as a benchmark, how do we really look at that on an aggregated level?
Mm-hmm. So I can...
Go ahead.
Sure. So when you look at adjustment to practice, things we're looking for evidence, your lesson planning, your structure of your class, how do I know that you changed what you were doing based on student needs? So you have your information of how students performed. It might be on a letter sound assessment. It could be on a reading assessment, a math assessment, whatever that assessment may be. I need to see what your plan of action will be to meet those student needs. And it's going to be multiple plans of actions because we no longer teach one lesson to the entire group. There are multiple layers of lessons for students, for those that need extensions, for those that need reteaching, and the reteaching may be a different approach to meet that skill. And at the end, we need to set some time frames of when we're going to check again to determine our effectiveness. And there are times we need to veer to a different approach to meet those needs or carry on because we are seeing growth. So the evidence of adjustment to practice is going to be varied lesson plans and goals, as well as then results of progress monitoring, if you will. So it doesn't need to be a full-blown assessment, almost like a dipstick check along the way. Are we seeing growth or movement there for that? Because we don't want to wait till the end of the year or the end of a unit and, oh, sorry, I guess that didn't quite work. Which I'm going to say, years ago, when I was in school myself, and even when I first started teaching, that's what you did. You had end of the year assessments, end of unit, and it was, okay, they're moving on to the next grade. But let them know this area is weak. And so now that is no longer acceptable.
So just let me add on, at the aggregate level,
you saw a wonderful example in the presentation that we did in terms of progress, where we had the coded grade level progress, yellow, pink, green, and you could see as a class where the kids started, whether or not they were progressing, and then the adjustment to practice is according to those levels. And so you can see at the aggregate level, Lauren called that at the beginning.
You're thinking of the literacy spreadsheets.
I am.
Yes.
But you called out at the beginning the expectation that all students will grow. They will grow at different speeds. But right. Watching that carefully, adjusting practice accordingly at the individual level, but also looking at the class level and then the grade level.
Yeah.
Is,
and
I
then
think
at this, yeah, and then this sort of all the way up, because I think what you just said, Mrs. DeBoe, is exactly why I see the value. Obviously, everyone does an adjustment to practice, right? This is not, it's a process metric, it's not an output metric, right? We get to see along the way, are we making changes that will actually benefit student outcomes, rather than getting to the end of the year and saying,
oops.
Yep. Exactly. Yep. So I guess that's where it, but I guess the follow on I'd have is, you just described a great example of sort of how an individual teacher uses it. Is there anything that we have around measuring, the only word that comes to mind is proficiency of teachers? I mean, is that a measure we can look at about it, how we rate sort of teachers' proficiency with this? Because it's a change.
So that's probably not a fair question for you.
No, I know, that's what I said. I was going both directions.
Go ahead.
If I could just because I think this would be a great conversation, if it's okay with you, for us to have at the July 7th meeting, because that's when we're going to be talking in more depth about DDMs, about student impact, all of the things that we touched on tonight in response to that letter, is something that I'd like to have a deeper conversation with the school committee.
Sure.
And in the end, what we're looking at is the reduction in the numbers of students, for example, needing special education services, the increase in the numbers of kids leaving grade level at benchmark, and then closing the gap where we know the gaps are. So working from both ends. So that's where you kind of look more at the aggregate and what we're doing. And it might be a better conversation, if that's okay.
That's perfect for me. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks.
No,
I just know there's many waiting in the wings.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I know. And I do like to talk. I'm sorry.
Does anyone else have a question?
No, that was great.
Thank you.
Yes,
okay, thank you.
I have one question. I'm sorry. I don't mean to let you go. I was giving everyone else the opportunity. Don't run yet. My only question is, in terms of the goal that you had last year for the responsive classroom, and one of the challenges that was listed was that not all the staff are responsive classroom trained, but yet we're going to continue using responsive classroom under the umbrella of the SEL that you were discussing as the current goal. How are we still working to get everyone trained, I guess?
So responsive classroom, we will not continue to seek training for that. Our guidance counselor, those that are responsive to trained, now are able to share how you conduct morning meeting, what are the components of it. We have resources that we can share with teachers. For the full training of it, it is not necessarily essential as we broaden that view of social emotional learning. What's essential are morning meeting, how do we go about it, what is it, working with mentors for new staff that might not be trained. When you look at across the elementary schools, how many teachers have been trained, how many have implemented it by learning from others. One of the challenges is the training is a week-long training. We cannot lose our teachers for a week during the school year, so it traditionally happens over the summer. Center has a lot of young parents, so I think that impacts the availability for our teachers. So while we are implementing it and they're doing a great job, it is not necessarily the official responsive classroom training. There is also a significant cost for responsive training. To maintain it, it would take a majority of our professional development budget each year from the district. That is why the HPTA was very generous in helping us support that. So we're not abandoning it. It is looking at taking the essential components of that, moving forward with it, but not necessarily being able to say that someone is officially, because they're very strict with their guidelines. You cannot say you're responsive classroom trained unless you attended XYZ with that. And there is a way to incorporate that with social emotional learning. When you look at the state guidelines, that is one of the approved, if you will, or acceptable avenues to implement those along with some other programs that you're able to use to support social emotional learning.
If we were to stick with that with fidelity, it would be all that we would be able to do.
Right.
I didn't recognize that as an issue. I also didn't recognize the fact that there is such strict guidelines on what considers to be trained. I guess my question was coming more from the are the teachers that aren't trained just out of luck kind of thing. You know, that was more of my, you know, and how is it going to breed consistency if not everyone's trained? That was where my question was stemming from. So that helps me understand it. And I certainly understand the train the trainer model. Yes. So that helps. I just was trying to figure out what happens with the rest of them, you know.
So the goal of having that social emotional learning team for that launching an approach to the school is to help provide guidelines for the consistency and how we do it to ensure it is common in the specialty areas, in the classrooms, kindergarten, the top floor, the lower floor. So that's the goal of comprising that group so that it is that unified school approach.
Gotcha.
It should greatly give us great return.
Perfect.
Okay.
Thank you, Lauren.
Excellent. Thanks so much.
Yes. So,
Principal Carver.
Yeah, Mrs. Carver.
How are you?
I'm well, thank you.
Welcome.
You? Thank you very much.
It's so great to see you here. This is your first.
It is
my school
first
improvement plan report.
Yes, it is.
Yep. Right. So bear with me.
I'll start by reading the members of my school council team this year. Myself as principal, Joanna Bawalik as principal coach, Kristen Conroy, grade 2 teacher, Leslie Pryor was a grade 2 teacher participant too, Christina Micho, a learning specialist, Mr. Shane Levy, a parent, Don Ronan, a parent, Kim Cooper, parent, and Laura Schnurr is listed there as a parent as well, and Amy Ritterbush, who is a former parent, participated as a community rep. So we had a nice team of folks and a lot of wonderful meetings. I started my school improvement plan by sort of updating, and I won't read through it, but to give you sort of a sense of where we have been and where we're headed. When I worked with the staff this year to kind of come to a decision about, you know, we get together and say, how are we doing with our plan? Here's the things that we talked about working hard with this year, and how do you feel we're doing? Most teachers, it felt really strongly that they're making great progress. But then when we break it all down to say, let's talk about each little part, we definitely had some successes. And our first goal last year was assessing writing using mastery learning targets. And we worked with Leslie Loud, who's I know you're familiar with her work in the district. And we worked with her to create mastery learning targets. But as you'll see later in my plan, we learned that we really needed to do a little bit more. Some of the challenges we had was creating fidelity with the writing SRSD this way, so horizontally and vertically, and also tying it into what the work that Center School had done. And we decided towards the end of the school year that we really needed to do some more. We needed more professional development and other things. Our second goal from our last school improvement plan was ensuring that all students were taught by teachers who use student data to adjust instructional instruction and plan lessons. And again, that was something that we decided we made some great strides, but we really needed to continue our work there, so we couldn't say, done, let's move on. We've done a lot of wonderful things. Lauren mentioned that we're sharing benchmark assessments with families this year. That's new. That was a little bit of a concern for some folks that we're gonna have this information out there, and it really proved to be quite helpful that families know just where kids are, and of course that's as it should be. And we met with families to talk about the BAS. We've got information about the benchmark assessments on our websites. And sharing that information with folks has been, we've gotten a lot of nice feedback about the importance of that. So what you'll see on the following pages is that I really have three new goals this year. Two of them are similar to previous years, but I'll highlight some of the changes. So my first goal is really just focusing on writing improvement. And so we will continue to use the SRSD self-regulated strategy development approach to writing, But what I'm hoping to be able to do is help the teachers at Elmwood School really get some roots with writing and with this process. I think that the professional development that we enjoyed this year gave us a nice overview of what the SRSD looks like. And there were a lot of evidence throughout the year that kids' writing was really coming along, just the fact that kids wrote more. One of the successes that we had this year, on the first day of MCAS, ELA MCAS, we typically have kiddos that take about 45 minutes to finish the day one of their, and that's a lot of writing on day one. And this year we waited and waited and waited, and we're, you know, well, how come they're not finishing? Typically the teachers are calling in to say, I'm done for the day. The kids wrote much more this year than they have in the last 2 years that I've been at Elmwood. So that's a big success. And we want to make sure that we don't just say, here you go, folks, but that we say, let's continue the good work that we started this year. So the staff is really enthusiastic about the process, and we want to use pre-assessment data for writing and post-assessment data for writing. And one of my plans this year that I'm really excited about is we're going to do a book study. So we're really going to take apart the parts of SRSD that we want to make sure folks are focused on. We want to make sure that people are prepared for the planning, the revisiting, the revising, editing, and that all teachers at Elmwood School are feel good about using that writing process. And one of the other things, we want to provide this, the notion of self-regulated strategies is something that is, that's the focus of this writing program, but it's self-regulation really speaks to kids being able to monitor their work, their emotions. It's something that we talk about in our, we have a social emotional goal at Elmwood this year too, and that self-regulation comes in to our social emotional learning as well. So we put some of the things that we really hope to do is improve feedback to students. So we're getting kiddos to write a lot more, but we need to be specific about what's good about what they're doing, what areas do they need to improve in. And so improving our feedback to students will be an important process this year. Also documenting the progress, and in some cases a lack of progress, will be really important so that we can ensure that students are making the growth that we're looking for. So the second goal on this year's school improvement plan is a social emotional learning goal. And what I think you'll hear is that there's consistency between Center and Elmwood. In some cases it will look different because of the grade levels, but something that we've really made a concerted effort to do this year is to make sure that we're bridging between the schools. And so Lauren and I worked together to talk about what kinds of things we want to use with the second and third graders. Certainly you heard the difference between preschool and first grade, and there's also an important difference as you get to second and third grade. But one of the things that we want to be intentional about is creating an environment where if children feel good about themselves, they're going to make academic progress. We can't separate out the two things. And there's a lot of evidence to support the idea that when kids feel good, they do good. And so that's what we really want to support. We'll have a school-wide survey to start the year that we can have a temperature of where are specific teachers in this process, as well as what are we already doing well. We don't need to start from scratch. We're doing some good things. But what places do we need to add to? As Lauren has already mentioned, we will continue to use responsive classroom. And what we've done a lot of this year is modeling for teachers are modeling for one another. So if we had a teacher that was not trained in in responsive classroom, they're going to see a lot of those elements in a classroom where they're visiting a model lesson. We've had the health teachers are watching teachers use responsive classroom. They're having morning meetings in art and music and PE. They're trying to incorporate those things, and that's a wonderful thing to see. We will also use the social emotional learning curriculum on the Department of Ed. Again, it's a guideline at our grade level. But what I'm really excited to do is create a sort of a health and wellness team. That will consist of our BCBA, our health and PE teachers, the guidance, the school psychologist, the school nurse and teachers, and come up with a nice team of folks that can focus on those needs of kids. Something else that I've outlined in the school improvement plan that I would like to be intentional about is we have a learning support team for academic needs of students, but what I really want to make sure that teachers feel good about is bringing the students to that LST process when it's only social things or emotional things or behavioral things, because as I've already said, those things can get in the way of academics. So when a teacher has a child who they feel is struggling behaviorally or socially or emotionally, I want them to come to our support team and seek assistance. We might, rather than having learning specialists attend those meetings, we might invite our wellness team to come and hear what are some of the challenges for the teacher or the students or both. So that's part of our plan. And my third goal is to, it's again, a adjustment to practice. And I think we're doing a nice job of making teachers aware that this is something that we need to do, but implementing that adjustment is really a challenge. And helping, I know Lauren sort of alluded to this, but when I was in school and when I started teaching as well, there was really an idea of, I taught it, they didn't learn it. And so what we really need to focus on is if they didn't learn it, you didn't really teach it. So how can we help teachers identify places where the learning didn't take place, why didn't it? In some cases, it's getting teachers to come together and share their stories. That happens in a professional learning community where they share data, they go through their data, they, ooh, look at your class. They really seemed to do well with this where my class struggled. What did you do? Sometimes it's conversations, sometimes it's a gentle nudge from an administrator who's been in a classroom and sees some places where changes can be made. And sometimes it's we're standing back and letting the teachers kind of collaborate and say, look, I'll try this. And even veteran teachers are sometimes hearing from someone else, I'd never thought to try it that way. So that's a focus that we'll consider during PLCs, and something that we tried very hard to implement this year, and time is always a struggle, is to have a grade level common planning time. So at Elmwood this year, we took every once a week, we had all of the students in a particular grade meet with the administrators and gave the teachers 30 minutes to, and 30 minutes is not nearly enough, but have a half an hour where they could work as a team to talk about things that were important to their grade level. It's hard to provide the coverage for, 12 second grades, but we managed it, and so that common planning was something that teachers really valued, and we'll continue to implement that. And I think that's really, in a nutshell, those are the things that we'll be working on this year. Do you have any questions for me?
Anyone have any questions?
Just, again, it's really, really well done. I really particularly appreciate the updates of, what you did over the course of this year. That's really helpful. And, I'm seeing the thread, which I know we'll continue to see, of consistency across the schools, which we haven't always seen. And so I think that's such a tremendous benefit to families across the district and to students, all having the same experiences and same language and same expectations. And so I think it's just vastly improved.
Parent came to me after the last school council meeting and said that's something that in her world that parents are starting to recognize, that they can really feel a sense of teamwork and a continuation from school to school. So we'll continue to work on that.
That's great.
Yeah. I'd also applaud your creativity in taking all the students and reading to them while the teachers get their turns, because I hear about it from my second grader all the time, how she gets excited when there's time to read with Mrs. Carver. So I think it's appreciated on the student level as well as the teacher level.
Well, that's
so
nice. And it's nice for me too. A couple of times other people have stepped in to say, I could do that for you. I'm sure you're really busy. And I have said, I really enjoy it. And it's a nice time to connect with kids. So I think it's good for all of us.
Well done.
Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you very much.
And next we have Team Hopkins. Oh, you're coming up alone?
I think so.
Well, I was going to.
I know.
Ready. Well, you have to at least come up. And this is a team effort. Please come up, although you don't get to talk. How's that? I wanted to, but I was all ready to do this because I was going to say I'd like to welcome incoming Principal Vallelo.
Thank you.
And acknowledge outgoing Principal Kernan. And I think it really is important to see you both here, because I know that the school improvement plan is the result of a real partnership and work that
I'm excited to see continuing, partly because I know that you've both been so involved in the planning of it. So, Mr. Kernan, it's very important that you be here. And it's also wonderful to give you an opportunity to present the school improvement plan. So welcome to you both.
And plus, Mr. Kernan, we wouldn't have the ability to formally say thank you and goodbye to you. Yes. So we certainly want that opportunity because it's been a pleasure working with you the 2 years that I've been on the committee. And so it certainly will be missed.
Thank you. Appreciate that. It'll be very, it'll be a difficult day tomorrow. So saying goodbye to my friends and students and colleagues. So it'll be a tough day tomorrow. So take it away.
Thank you. So I would like to also thank all of our members of our school council. And as I start to tell the story of where we're going in the future, this group has been really integral in that. The conversations we've had moving from both last year's school council and this year's school council has really driven what you'll see are some changes in directions a little bit, particularly when we talk about our social emotional goal moving forward. So our members being Marie Clark, a learning specialist at fourth grade, Mary Beth Tremblay, a fifth grade teacher, Joan Frank, our learning literacy specialist, lit support, Alexis Miller, Laura Berry, Andy Young, Trisha LeGlen, who are all parents, and Don Ronan, who serves as our community representative. So thank you to all of them, because the conversations we've had with parents, as I get to particularly that second goal, they were really very integral in our conversations and what has driven where we went with that second goal. Over the past 2 years as a school, we've been really focused on our looking at data in various teams, and you've heard this from the other schools as well, refining our understanding of how we work with data and looking at all of the information we gather on students and then using that to drive our instruction. And a big focus of our second goal last year was improving our student outcomes. Once you get to our school, you know, we have the data from the state, and we have a lot of assessment data. And those high need students, by the time they reach fourth grade, that those gaps are large. The demands on what our frameworks tell us we need to teach, the standards are significant now. And so students at fourth and fifth grade, you see those gaps widening. And so recognizing that we need interventions that serve all of our students, that we can't have a one size fits all curriculum and instructional strategies, becomes very important. So we have our standards, and those frameworks tell us where all of our students need to strive to reach, but we need to get there with different methods. And the fact that we utilize the reading and writer's workshop model has been wonderful to help differentiate instruction, but expanding our tool set, giving our teachers more interventions to work with struggling students, has been a big focus of what we've done the last 2 years at Hopkins. And our conversations and our professional learning communities have really grown over the past 2 years as well. That's been a focus, and it's driven another area, our first goal last year, which was working on formative assessments. We talk a lot about those big benchmarks, the MCAS results, or you're using Galileo information to drive instruction, but working with teachers to recognize the importance of formative assessments ongoing, and you've heard this as a theme from the last two schools as well. The information that you can gather from quick assessments, exit tickets, there's so much information on students that can drive that differentiation and adjustment to practice. And so we've really focused on building those into our practice. A lot of our work has been in the area of reading and math. And moving forward, we know that there's been a lot of work going on at Center and Elmwood with the SRSD. And one of the things that's come out of conversations with our school council, parents who have students in different schools, is that need for some consistency. And writing instruction is the first area that we'd like to focus on in the next year, because one, our data shows us that that's the area our students tend to struggle the most. So when you look at the, you know, their ability to read and comprehend their math, they're doing very well, but we struggle with their written response. And part of that is this grade level, the expectations on how much you write at fourth and fifth grade. So we would like to continue the work that's happening at Center in Elmwood and build those strategies into our work at Hopkins. I think there's a lot of value in using some common language. We talk about having the what, the frameworks telling us what we need to teach. The how is where teachers can bring in their art, right? How they're going to teach that is important. And we don't want to lose that. But having common language, experiences from classroom to classroom, building on language or experiences they've had in second and third grade, are valuable because students thrive when they have that comfort. And so if we can use that common language to build in the future, we think it'll really help our students write and grow. So a big focus next year, that first goal, will be on using the SRSD program as our professional development to continue the work in writing. When we're looking at writing, we talk about the genre area writing. So when you look at the frameworks in literacy at this grade, these grade levels, we focus on informational writing, persuasive writing, and narrative writing. Those are the genre writings, and we've done a lot of work in those areas already. We need to continue that work, and we'd like to see some common language and also rubrics being implemented. So teachers working together, and this is where we'd like to see a lot of our PLC time moving in the future, is developing some common rubrics so that there's a commonality of how you look at writing and understand where students are and how to move them forward. The other type of writing that is critical, and we know that this is something, you know, when you look at standardized assessments, what the expectations are, is response to reading and that on-demand writing. When we've been using the MCAS for the last quite few years, we've seen a lot of formulaic writing come into play. You see students really focused on that open response style, and it became very formulaic. And we know moving forward that the expectations are our students think more critically about what the questions are. And we believe that the SRSD program will help take us to that next level. We've been using the landmark strategies, and I think our work with landmark strategies on two column notes, analyzing what a question is asking you, main idea, it fits really nicely, and that work has continued up into sixth grade at the middle school. And so merging both that and the SRSD programs to help us have more commonalities in our writing. So that's the first area of focus. The second area, our other goal, is social emotional again, as you've heard that theme coming across, but we've shifted a little bit this year. In the past 2 years, we've done a lot of work, as you've heard from the other schools, on implementing responsive classroom model at Hopkins, continuing that experience for students. Again, moving and transitioning between buildings, having that morning meeting experience, building classroom communities and school communities is really important. And we've also worked on strengthening our wellness program to include a lot of work in social emotional learning. So we have a lot of those things in place. What we have learned through our parent feedback, both in meetings that we go to, in our school council, and also in conversations with children, is that the stress and anxiety when you reach Hopkins School because of the grade levels, the expectations on work demands, we've reached a point where we need to assess how much we're doing and the demands that that places on students. And so when you look at our second goal for next year, we're shifting and really focusing on two areas that we have recognized and identified as a group, parents, students, and teachers, as really bringing upon a lot of stress and anxiety to students and faculty for sure, and I think parents as well. The two areas being our homework practices and our assessment practices. So we've put into place all of these great assessments, but how do we look at that and figure out, is it starting to take away from instructional time? Can we do more formative assessment work where it's weaved into our instruction or project-based experiences and gather data through solid writing rubrics that give us information through experiences rather than always saying you need to do an open response writing or you need to take a summative test on every science topic? Because I think the number of assessments that students have come up so much. So you go from a second or third grade experience and all of a sudden you have tests in science class, you have your social studies tests to study for, a math assessment. So can we narrow down the key focus areas and make a better experience so that we're still gathering the same information, but perhaps without the frequency of the students feeling like they're being tested, over tested. And the other area of focus being homework, examining our homework practices and making sure there's some commonality. And when I was interviewing with you all to talk about my hopes for the future, this is one area I really think that we need to tackle. And it's not just a Hopkinton problem, but I think there are such different expectations from families and a community on what homework should be. And we've gotten really good about differentiating our structure in the classroom. We recognize it's not one size fits all. But homework is one area that still, there's this expectation that everybody does the same thing. And not everybody goes home to the same experience. Not everybody utilizes the same amount of energy in a classroom. And we need to look at, is that homework experience enhancing their classroom experience in a way that's healthy? Or is it adding a stress that is making school less enjoyable for our students? And so we want to explore that as a community, including our parents and students. And I know that this is a conversation that's going to be happening broader. It already is happening as a community. But at our grade level, we feel it's really critical to focus on this because, you know, as that bridge into the middle school world, we know we can't abandon homework altogether. But how do we make it an experience that helps our students rather than hurting them?
So I'd like to just acknowledge that it was the Hopkins School that really raised this issue to the admin team, which then everybody really was interested in looking at it more closely. And because you raised it, it has now become a district-wide initiative that will result in a district-wide committee with the goal of having recommendations in place for the fall. So I think not only looking at social-emotional, but then really drilling down to some specific areas that can make an immediate difference has been really helpful. And I just wanted to add that in there before I turn you back over. But thank you for that report, Vanessa.
Sure. Any questions, anybody?
I just wanted to piggyback on that too as well. I mean, stress is a topic that you hear about everywhere you go, from parents down to students, regardless of the school. And so I think, you know, the consistent focus across all of these school improvement plans on the social emotional needs of students obviously is really critical. But in addition, so there's always going to be stress, and so learning how to manage the stress for yourself is really important. But I think in addition, asking yourselves those difficult questions about what are we doing with our homework, and is it productive, genuine, authentic, whatever is the right word, enough to warrant the time that we're asking the students and the families to spend on it, I think is a really hard question. And so I think but tremendously beneficial to everybody for the asking. So I applaud you for taking that on. That's a big challenge.
It is. And as I said, I think it's a societal challenge. And so balancing that with a school, you know, the other piece I wanted to acknowledge, having her in today, you know, you have given us the benefit of having a new adjustment counselor, mm-hmm. adding to our staff. And so as part of our social emotional experience at Hopkins, I am so excited to report that we've found somebody and we're starting to craft out what that's going to look like. And as far as enhancing our social emotional learning, you know, having an additional staff member, an adjustment counselor, to build on all of the great work that our teachers do with Responsive Classroom, that's part of our community, but also the supports for our students who are really struggling. And that's a key thing that school committee, you know, approving that in our budget is essential and is going to help provide the supports for the students who really do need those interventions, but also supporting the overall instruction. You know, bringing in things like zones of regulation that can really support the work that Responsive Classroom does for helping students understand and regulate where they are. It goes along nicely with our work with SRSD as well, academically. Thank you.
So I also didn't want to shortchange you in the opportunity to update us on prior goals and where, mm-hmm. where you've come since last year.
Yep. So if you go to page, ours are actually in the back, starting on page 8. So the first area, and I mentioned this earlier, was our improving our assessment practices. And I would say one of our biggest additions to that this year has been implementing some more formative work in the reading comprehension area, and it actually is writing as well. We've utilized some things called the qualitative reading inventory and implementing it across classrooms. They're quicker assessments that can give us data on how students are doing and can be implemented as a whole class as part of your instructional practice, rather than sitting down, you know, there's discussions about, you know, do we continue programs like Galileo, those kind of assessment practices. And as that's been going on, we have been trying to implement quick checks in mathematics, for example. Those have become more common practices. The QRI and reader's response experiences utilizing our Chromebooks. This year, having the 2-to-1 has enabled a lot of teachers to start using the Chromebooks as a way for students to respond to reading. In that model, where the teacher can actually see what the students are writing and respond to them back and forth, which is a form of formative assessment. The teachers are gathering the data on how the students are writing about their reading and then giving them immediate feedback on that writing. So those are some of the ways that our assessment practices, the formative experiences, and a lot of that has been driven through our professional learning communities. So when you're looking at our school, the heart of that is the National Park teamwork. I feel, you know, that's where the teachers are most comfortable. We continue that work at the grade level meeting during building-based meetings, but talking about student work. And this year, that's been a huge focus, looking at student work and then using that to drive how we change where we go in the future. That second goal, as I talked about earlier, was really looking on our struggling students, and that was building in those intervention strategies and programs. So some of the things we've brought in for our students who are really struggling, for example, our Just Words program to improve decoding. We've brought in a lot of fluency work to improve students' fluency, and the Leveled Literacy Intervention Program, which is an overall reading program, but those are some examples of reading and writing interventions we've put into place to improve our struggling learners. And then in the math, recognizing that Envision is a great program and there are intervention tools built into that, but also expanding into other alternatives such as Jump Math that continue to provide the standards-based learning we need to give students, grade level expectations, but using different approaches and techniques to help students master that. So those would be the two goals, and then this social emotional goal, which was focused on feeling safe and supported. And this is really where we implemented our wellness teachers have implemented a lot of work in this as part of their curriculum as they teach the health class. And there was a lot of work on refining the health curriculum this year. A lot of the focus of our third goal was in the wellness realm this year and finding out from students where their stress and anxiety was coming from, which again drove where we're going into the future in these two areas under social emotional learning. So
I didn't have the question. It was more just so that we had the overview.
Sure.
Anyone have any questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Tim. Good luck.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
And just so you know, next year we won't give him any credit for anything.
Okay.
Although the template is nice looking. I think he did develop that, right?
So Principal Keller just finished an eighth grade, as we know, promotion. I know he didn't mind coming tonight because there's also an eighth grade dance going on, I believe.
As we speak,
he
yes.
He's safe for all of them now.
I've been keeping tabs with my
sister. I'm sorry that we had to leave, but as always, it's so heartwarming.
Oh yeah.
And you know, they really do grow up so much in those short years. But then having just come from the high school promotion night, you just see how much they grow from eighth grade until they graduated. So it was fun, right?
It was fun. Great. Yeah,
appreciate
the kids,
being
the kids were so proud.
Yeah, it's a nice night. So thank you. And thank you for having me to talk about my school improvement plan for next year. So I just want to acknowledge, as my predecessors have, our school council
So this year, school council, it was my two assistant principals and me, Linda Brooks, Sally Stugels, and Laura Kirschenbaum, three teachers. This year is the first year, it was one of our goals for last year, to get students more involved in the leadership of the school, and so this is, was our first year having students. I know the high school has done that, and we liked that idea, and so this year we brought on Cassidy Barada, Odara D'Oliveira, Liam Ford, and Luke Joseph, and they did an outstanding job. And we had four parents, Maureen Belger, Beth DeLiva, Allison Murphy, and Nancy Kavanaugh, as part of our school council. So thank you, of course, to all of them. So I have four goals. We have four goals, I should say, for next year. The structure is similar to the way I formatted my school improvement plan from last year in looking at curriculum, instruction, and assessment as the first three goals. So the first goal is around curriculum, and it is in some ways we're continuing some of the goals that we established last year around curriculum, and that was to really target all academic courses around subject-specific learning targets, essential standards that we're writing in student and parent-friendly language. So as many of you will recall, we did a lot of work in Atlas years ago around understanding by design, and so we're taking that information and turning those into saying what are truly the essential pieces of that and putting that in student and parent-friendly language. So we've had a PLC, Professional Learning Community Steering Committee, that's been extensively involved and meets on a weekly basis, and they've been steering us down that process and helping teachers to understand exactly what needs to be populated in this template that we've created. So that work is ongoing. The other big piece around curriculum for next year is realigning our science curriculum. Dr. Kavanaugh actually was with my science curriculum leader. It was yesterday, I believe. Was that yesterday or the day before?
I think Tuesday.
Yeah. And so one of the big things in science is the new standards that have been released from the state. And so we're putting a lot of time and energy into unpacking those standards for the following year and beginning to understand what that's going to mean. It's going to mean a lot of realigning of our science curriculum. So they're going to be working this summer on beginning to unpack those and then throughout the school year. Our second goal is around instruction, and that is ensuring that our instructional practices are aligned to our mission. And so we have really three strategies and activities, and I'm on page five here. And so three big pieces around instruction are, as Vanessa and Anne, and I believe Lauren mentioned as well, I came halfway through with Lauren, so I apologize, I didn't hear that lengthy presentation. So we are beginning next year around the SRSD program with Leslie Lawn, and so so far in the past couple of months we've worked, we've had several conversations with Leslie. Leslie's actually presented to several of the members of our English department and our special education department, so we're beginning that work next year. It's really a two-year implementation of SRSD to continue the consistency from the elementary levels, and so she'll be working with our English teachers and our special education teachers next year, as well as beginning to work with social studies introduce those strategies and having some common writing expectations across the grade level. And I'm sure that everybody would say this, we have outstanding teachers of writing, but they lack consistency, the teachers that is, from teacher to teacher and from subject to subject. So that's one of the things we're really excited about, the English teachers as well. The other piece that we've talked about is there is this book called Visible Learning, and in it, it talks a lot about, the whole book is about instructional strategies that are research-based that are proven to have an impact on student learning. So one of our goals next year is to begin with our curriculum leaders to do a book study with that book and ultimately select instructional strategies that we would like to see implemented that we're going to devote professional development time to. So that's one of our goals for next year, is to spend a lot of time with that book, Visible Learning, and determine what instructional strategies. And finally, we're really excited to next year have a literacy coach. And so that literacy coach next year will work extensively with grade six. He or she will work with all teachers in professional development days, but during school, we'll be working a lot with focusing on helping our grade six teachers bring literacy to all academic subject areas. Our third goal is on assessment, and that's on pages 6 and 7. And I'm going to focus on page 7 around our main strategies and activities. And so we have, at the middle school, we're lucky enough to have scheduled professional learning community time in the school day for all teachers. Our academic teachers have more of it than our foreign language and our related arts teachers. And so one of the things that we began doing this year is what we called kind of PLC 2.0, and that was to really drive those conversations around looking at assessment data and to be making decisions as I've heard everybody kind of talk about is this adjustment to practice. So, okay, our students took this test and struggled with it. We don't want to just say, you know, you got a 60 on this and move on. It's what are we going to do about that 60 and how are we going to adjust our practice to help that student? Because going back to our instructional goal, if we're saying that these are essential standards that every child must learn them, then if they're not learning them, as a 60 would be evidence of how are we going to reteach that or get that child to understand that concept. We also are really committed to having our students play a role in that, and it's not to just be teacher-driven. And so our teachers have begun, particularly our science department, have begun utilizing a graphic organizer in which students are taking an assessment, and as they're taking the assessment, they're also kind of being metacognitive about that. And so talking about these are the things that I knew, these are the things I kind of guessed at, and these are the things that I need some additional help with. So that's one of the strategies that we've worked on as a school quite extensively. And so we're building that into a lot of our assessments and trying to get our students to be more reflective as to where they are on their path to proficiency. And finally, and this is something that those of you that have been on school committee for a while know that as a middle school, we are committed to this idea of response intervention, and the adjustment to practice really is speaks loudly to us in that realm. And so we're looking at the evidence and how are we going to respond and how are we going to identify appropriate interventions and enrichments for those students, because it's not just about the student who got a 60 and struggles that needs some help, but it's also about the student who took the test and got 100. And so we're just about to begin the unit and you already have 100. How are we going to enrich that child's learning? So those are the curriculum instruction and assessment pieces. Our fourth goal then really gets to a safe and supportive learning and social environment. It's the social emotional goal that we have, and that's on pages 8 and 9. And it's on pages 8, 9, and 10. And so I'm going to look at page 10 where we talk about strategies and activities. Our big piece this year is one of our school improvement plan goals for this year was to establish a mission, and we have that in draft form, and we're pretty proud of what we have as a draft. We're prepared to begin to introduce that, and I know the group is anxious to meet with Dr. McLeod and share the mission. And then we're ready to move forward on once we feel good about our mission to move forward on our vision and core values for next year. So that's one of our goals. We also are looking to establish a health and wellness task force that's going to look at the offerings that we have before, during, and after school for students around health and wellness, and to identify some opportunities for us to meet our students' needs in that regard. We're also really excited. One of our teachers, Samantha Harris, has done some extensive work around restorative practices. And so she organized a group. Dr. McLeod identified some professional development. And so there were members, Bruce Elliott as our wellness director, Evan Bishop organized some teachers from the high school that went to a workshop on restorative practices. And we were thrilled to get a grant from the Ed Foundation to begin to implement some restorative practices into the middle school and high school, and also some mindfulness pieces, so that we're going to be looking at that as professional development for our teachers to be employing some restorative practices in the middle school. And essentially, in a nutshell, what a restorative practice is, for those that aren't aware, is instead of looking at a student and saying, you did something wrong, you get a consequence. Certainly, we still need to look in that realm, but restorative practices is saying you did something wrong. How are we going to make that right? You're a member of this community. These are the people that you offended by this. And so as a member of this community, here's how we need to build, begin to restore you in the eyes of your peers. And so it's a really a whole body kind of experience, and that we're looking at the whole student is essentially what a restorative practice is. And then finally, a lot of feedback from parents and from students around communication. And so we've worked with Ashok Ghosh as well as our technology integration specialist to help our teams establish communication hubs that are more user-friendly on the parent end of things. Because right now, as a parent, You may have to go in 3 or 4 different places to get information about your child's homework or team events, and so that we're committed to streamlining that. So those are our 4 goals.
I'll just point out that I know it sounds like a lot. One of the things that Alan and I spoke about when we were looking at his school improvement plan was that when you look through the person responsible column, you can see that although there are many, many goals, he has targeted the areas of responsibility so that it doesn't feel like this is all coming at anyone. This is not all teacher targeted. So you've been using your staff and your PLCs and your support network in a way that allows you to accomplish a lot.
Thank you. I wanted to mention that. Yes, I forgot about that, Kathy. Yeah, so our curriculum leaders are taking on a substantial role in this, and we have a curriculum leader in each of the academic areas in rolling this out to the departments and working with the departments. They're also playing a significant role in establishing that professional development plan for the school year. Absolutely.
Yeah, and the book study.
And the book study, yes. Mm-hmm.
Any questions?
I have just a comment, which is, as I'm listening to you talk, I think, I'm not going to say this correctly, but I think I'm also hearing a lot of focus on students adjusting their own practice, for lack of a better term, just in terms of, as they're taking a test, being aware of what they need help with, and because teachers can make adjustments all day long, but if students aren't meeting them halfway, and I think that they need the skills to be able to do that, and you hear about parents always talking about study skills and whatnot. So I just really, that jumped out at me when you were talking about it, and I think that in conjunction with what you said about the restorative
practices.
I really like that. I'm just hearing a little bit more accountability, developmentally appropriate accountability and expectations on your end from the students, which I think is really, really good. So thank you.
Anybody else?
No, the only comment I'd have is you mentioned right at the beginning when you went through your list, I think the addition of the students, I hope that's been as beneficial as I think it would be. I think that's a great addition to start getting them involved in owning owning their community and their school, and it feels like it feels like the right age to start having that involvement. So,
yeah, it was really powerful. So we did 8th graders this year, and I think it was our first year doing it, and there were definitely some times where, and I think Nancy can probably attest to this. There were times where I think they were a little bit bored with some of what we were talking about. So we talked about finding some ways where we can branch off and have them looking at a particular at a particular item that maybe isn't of all that interest, but they brought a lot to the meetings and talked a lot about some things that if we were just adults sitting around in a room we would have missed. And so yeah,
that's great.
So definitely want to give you the opportunity to update us on last year, despite the fact that we threw Lauren under the bus on her own. But I will say we're not running late on this segment yet, so you're still okay.
Yes, I'd be happy to do that. I think I would. So
for us, it was page 11. Not to be prepared to do that, by the way.
What?
I did tell him he didn't have to be prepared to do that.
Oh.
Oh, there we go. Thank you. No, I've got it.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, because it was in here. I figured that. Oh, okay.
So last year, we structured it the same way as I attempted to say at the beginning. Last year's school improvement plan was structured the same way. So we had our first goal was around curriculum, and so as I mentioned earlier, we each course had begun to establish those essential standards that were expressed in student and parent friendly language. So last year we did that, we did that in units. I think we started with the first, and I think focused on the first and I think third units because it was new to people, so it took a little bit more time to establish those. So this year, next year coming back, they're going to focus on all the other remaining units that they weren't able to get to this year. And again, in the curriculum area, we're providing students with learning targets, so they have a real specific understanding of what's coming to them, and we're trying to, again, make sure that that's all in student-friendly and parent-friendly language. On page 12, then, around instruction, we did a lot of work around professional development this year on utilizing the technology and not just saying, here's the Chromebook and here's how great a tool it is, but rather what are the things around curriculum instruction and assessment that technology can improve. So we worked on different tools around differentiated instruction, enhancing organization. So I think Vanessa mentioned the landmark system. So we've had landmark, I think that began 3 years ago at the middle school in a joint effort between Hopkins and the middle school. And so we took those things that were the paper materials and the binder materials and are working on making those electronic, and so that the kids' Chromebooks look just like their physical binder looks. So we did a lot of work around that. And then also with Ashok and with Crystal Ho, our technology integration coordinator, we've done a lot of cyber cafe models, and we've had teachers, rather than it's always being an outside professional or a principal or an assistant principal leading professional development, we've had teachers doing this kind of cyber cafe model where teachers are rotating every 20 minutes to a half an hour and having a teacher present them with some information, and the teacher's going back and actually shaping a lesson or a unit using what they learned from that. And then on page 13, our third goal is around measuring assessment and advancing learning. We have worked extensively on revising and updating formative, summative, and benchmark assessments. And one of our goals that's continuing in the next year is establishing universal screening tools. That's one of the things that we need to have right at the outset. A universal screening tool is something that the kids take right away on day one or day two that give us immediate information on this kid is struggling with writing, reading, or any of the other subject areas. And so that's a goal that's ongoing. And then our last goal, which is on page 14, was around collective responsibility. And so I mentioned the mission. And so we have a draft mission for Hopkinton Middle School. And that we're looking to roll that out in the fall of 2016 and then continue with our vision and core values. And that's essentially what we were able to accomplish this year.
Which is a lot. Does anyone have any questions?
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Alan.
Thank you.
Mr. Bishop.
Welcome.
How you doing? Well, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it and having this opportunity. I know you guys do have a pretty full agenda, so I'll do my best to stay focused, to be brief, and talk about the goals for the high school next year. I do also, like my colleagues, want to acknowledge the 24 members of the school council at the high school.
Wow.
Parents Abby Rosenberg, Diane Bird, Linda Katz, Melissa Abate, and community member Ron Foisey. Teachers Diane Millett, Ken Gates, Tricia Noblet, Shannon Alberry, Sherry Meyer, and Lee Greco. In students, Maggie Reynolds, Ariana Turner, Ben Nigresh, Chris Sarba, Colette Fritchie, Haley Sinical, Jacob Schmidt, Ted Torres, Lucas DeLoya, Olivia Rosen, and Sarah Lickett. I also want to thank the SMLs at the high school, as well as the assistant principals and central office for helping to craft the goals this year. I do want to take a second to say it's nice to go last and be able to hear my colleagues talk about their focus areas and their priorities and how much they align with the high school. I really do feel that's unique. I don't think a lot of schools have the connection K through 12 like we do. That's the cohesiveness and the focusing on what's important both inside of the classroom and outside of the classroom for our students is a really special thing. And I think it speaks to Dr. McLeod's leadership and vision, strategic plan, and I think that we're moving in a great direction, and I'm really proud of the work at the high school and proud of the work at the district, and I'm just really excited to be part of it. So we have three goals at the high school. We always typically try to have three goals. It's a continuation or an enhancement mostly for the three goals, so I'll talk a little bit about what we did this past year and how that kind of continues over to this year. So one of the goals is around assessment. One of the goals is around the social, emotional health and well-being of our students. And the third goal is around supporting students at all academic levels, whether it's the highest level, our struggling students, our high-need students, or those students in between. It's going to be a focus of ours this year. So in regards to our first goal, this past year it was 100% of our teachers would create common formative assessments. Now I know Vanessa talked very articulately about formative assessments. I like to think of it as the practice before the game and how you're going to adjust to be able to get to the game. And so we use that analogy quite a bit. And so we created them. Every teacher has created common formative assessments for all of their units of study. So that was a big accomplishment first this year. And so next year, of this upcoming year, it's more about what are we going to do with the results. Okay, so we have all this information. How are we going to adjust our practice? How are we going to reflect on the data? to be able to get our kids to where they need to be. I've been at the high school for 11 years, in administration for 6 years. We've had quite a few initiatives, quite a few things that we do in terms of goals. This is one that I've seen that the teachers have bought into more than any other. They're invested in formative assessments. They see the value. Many of them have come and said it's improved their teaching. And so we're excited about this. You know, it's tough. I know you mentioned about how you're going to measure it. We're going to have the teachers come up with a document at the end of the year about how they adjusted their practice, kind of holistically based on some of the formative assessments that they used. You know it when you see it, and the teachers can tell you about it, and you can probably use maybe some grades at the end of the year to kind of assess it, but it's so valuable. And so it's a priority for us, certainly. So that's our first goal, is that now that we have them in place, how are we going to use them, and how are we going to adjust our practice? The second goal, which has been a goal since I've been principal and probably before me, and I know they've talked about it in the other buildings, is the social, emotional health and well-being of our students. It's one that we're invested in, we care very much about, but it's also a very difficult goal to show progress. And so our goal is really tied to the Metro West Adolescent Health Survey, and this really is a two-year goal, so we're going into our second year. We, on the 2015 survey, we had great scores in a lot of categories, but the stress category was really high. It went up significantly. So we are trying to decrease that statistic over the course of 2 years. So the students will be taking the survey in November. We'll get the results back in the spring. We've made quite a few efforts, from creating de-stress weeks, we call them, where we have fun games and activities throughout the course of the week. We have homework-free weekends and vacations. You know, we've tried a lot, and we feel like there's been some improvements, but not as much as we'd like to see. So we're going to kind of tweak some things next year when it comes to the de-stress ideas that we have. But what came out loud and clear in school council is that we need to get the parents more involved in this process. We've worked with students, we work with teachers, I think we're on the same page, but the missing piece of the puzzle is the parents. And so how we get them involved, that's going to be a challenge, but I know there's people that want to be involved. Maybe we can have parent nights, we could send out articles, we could have principal coffees, whatever it is, but I feel like they need to be part of this conversation about, yes, stress is a part of life, but how do kids manage it appropriately and healthy? That's the challenging part with the stress now that this is college, and most of the seniors applying by November 1st, which is a new thing over the last 2 or 3 years. And so it's a goal that we're committed to. I'd love to see that percentage go down based on the work that we're doing, and if it doesn't, it'll continue to be a goal for us, because I think it's very, very valuable and very, very important. So that's our second goal. Within that goal, you know, I wasn't here earlier, but I know you guys talked about the START program at the middle school. That's obviously 1 year in at the high school, and it's been a huge success. We also have created a writing center for students, which has also been very useful. So we've been doing some things, not just fun activities to reduce stress, but some real stuff inside the classroom that can help students as well. So that's an effort that we're making that, again, is a second, going into our second year of that goal. And the third goal is around supporting students at all levels. So 2 years ago, we were indicated as a level two school at the high school. And so we really wanted to get back to level one status. We're happy to report that this past year we were awarded back to level one status. And that's a goal that we want to consistently have. We want to have high standards. We want to reach that. And so that's our goal again this year, to remain a level one school. And it's supporting kids across the board. I think we do a really good job with students at the top end. We offer more APs than most schools in this area, and our students do an unbelievable job. We've been making some real progress with our high need students. We've created small group classes in English, math, and science. I've talked about the Writing Center. Our START program has serviced some of those kids as well. We've been doing quite a bit. We have a math remediation class. We have a biology remediation class. We've restructured our SPED department to better support our students. So we're making strides. What I feel is going to be coming next is the students that kind of fall into the middle. And so we really need to kind of focus our attention with this goal, but that's why we've underlined all, because we need to make sure we support all the kids. We have a tutoring center in place. We have things in place, but I feel like that's the group that really need to identify as we move forward. And so, you know, we had our highest MCAS scores in recent history last year. So we're excited about that. So we feel like some of the things we're doing are good, but we can't just rest on that. We have to continue to try to get better. And so that is a goal that is a high priority for us as well, is to remain at a level one status school. So those are our three formal goals. We do have some some other kind of informal goals. I know we've talked about the turf field project. That's something that that we're invested in, that I'm certainly invested in at the high school. Scheduling committee. We're going to look at our schedule. That kind of ties into the stress goal a little bit. I know there's a lot of conversation about start time. And so we've started that conversation. I think next year we'll focus a lot on that to see if that's what's best in regards to our students and if it might help with the social-emotional piece. And technology, I know Mr. Ghosh is here. He works tremendously hard at the high school and across the district. But we're going to have our teachers all have a learning management system that's consistent. So there's two of them. It's either going to be Canvas. I don't know if you're familiar with that platform. Or Google Classroom. So right now, teachers kind of use different things, and that can be stressful for a student when you have 12 teachers over the course of the year, and they have 10 different learning management systems. So we're trying to mainstream that. So a goal that I have for our teachers for next year will be that everybody has one of those two platforms, so students can access that material online if they're out or whatever it may be. So those are our goals at the school, which we're excited about. So if you guys have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Anyone? I'll continue on my stress theme and commend you as well for trying to address it. And I think that you're right that it's a partnership with parents and you know, just the same way at Hopkins, they're asking themselves a really difficult question around homework. I think, you know, parents, it's time for parents to ask a really difficult question of, you know, there are a lot of wonderful opportunities available to our kids, but where's the line between opportunity and stress, and which stresses do we choose to bring into our lives? So I think that's a great focus, particularly in combination with taking a deeper look at the middle child, mm-hmm. for lack of a better mm-hmm. word, the middle learners there. So great work, and you know, we have such a wonderful district, K-12, and I think you're right that the consistency is just really showing through. As we watch the kids, we started at center school yesterday, right, and then ended with high school graduation a couple weeks ago. So, thank you.
Welcome. I do want to take an opportunity to thank you all for coming to graduation. It was much appreciated. You know, the students, parents, and teachers really appreciated you being there. I know you're all busy, so thank you
night.
For taking the time.
It's a great night. Yeah.
I'd just like to comment too, and sort of in general. I mean, great job by everyone, but it was accidental due to scheduling that we had all of these on one night. But I think it actually was a really nice illustration to see from the preschool through the high school in an hour and 15 minutes to see the connections between all the schools, the fact that there's a social and emotional component to every single one of these, that consistency, that experience, I think is really, and as evidenced by the fact that the folks on TV can't see, but every single principal is still sitting here in the audience. So I think that just shows through the tremendous team that we have here in the district. And so that has been wonderful to see tonight. So thank you all.
And I agree. And we should definitely continue to do it this way. But before you all get up and leave, and I hope that you will, I just need to also echo just what remarkable leaders all of you are. And I'm sitting here and listening to you and am so very impressed at how articulate you are about the work that you're doing. You are instructional leaders within your building, and I've said this to all of you, which is why I think your teachers are on board, because they know that you understand those things that you're talking about. So I just, again, want to thank all of you, and then just to comment for anybody watching that I have heard from at one or two parents from every single one of your buildings this week, just talking about how they were thank you notes. They were thank you notes. Some of you were copied on them, some of you were not, but they were thank you notes to you and your teachers and your teams for the fantastic experiences that their children are having. And some of them were surprised, and were a little bit apprehensive when their children began, and some of them shared different challenges that their children had received, but every single one was really reaching out and or copying me just to say how much they appreciate the experiences that their children are having. And so for anybody watching, those are so appreciated by all of us, and so thank you for taking the time to do that, but thank all of you for showing up every day. So thanks for being here, and I really think you should all go now. and we have Mr. Ghosh here and Mr. Dumas.
Hello.
Thank you.
Come on up.
We have next on our agenda is Mr. Keller.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Keller. Yeah. We need you one last minute.
I was like, you might be excused too.
Then we have high school trips after that too. So
yes.
Okay. Yeah. Just want to make sure we don't.
Yeah. No, it's okay.
Mr. Keller doesn't want to go to the dance anyway.
It's only an intent.
Yeah, that's okay. That's fine. I just wanted to
make
sure
you saw it.
We've
seen your dance moves, though, on the lift up.
No, what was it? That wasn't that was the kids that did the lift up.
Good night.
You know what I mean?
There was a staff one, too.
To the left, to the left. That's all I remember.
So, thank you. We have just a couple minor updates to our student and parent handbook for next year. Excuse me. Couple minor things. This year we experimented with a social instead of a dance. We've traditionally always done dances, and so this year we actually had a courtyard event, and it went really, really well with the eighth grade, in which we were playing badminton and doing a whole variety of things, and the kids were really engaged, and so we found that to be a really nice activity, and so we added that instead of just dances as a school council activities, not school committee. We also are talking, you know, this year was our first year with Chromebooks, and so we were trying to be explicit in our handbook about damages of the Chromebooks are going to be the responsibility of parents, and we were not so explicit in last year's handbook. And then lastly, one of the things that we've talked about as a staff is going back to my earlier point and the comment that you made, Jean, about students taking on greater responsibility in the middle school. We have, in the past, we did not give students access to grades, and so 2 years ago we started doing that, and we continue to do that, and we continue to hear really positive things. We're taking our next step forward, and that is to have our grades available 24/7. So instead, we're moving away from monthly progress reports, and that grades would be available to parents and to students constantly. And so we've talked about that as a staff this year, and we're ready to take that jump. And so those are the three changes for next year's handbook.
I have a question about the Chromebooks. Just are those insured by the? Do parents purchase insurance on those, or does the school insure them as well?
Okay. No insurance is purchased on those.
Why not?
It's cheaper to budget for repairs than it is to pay the actual cost of the insurance currently.
Do they, with respect to that responsibility for damage, do parents, I'm familiar with the one-to-one parent-student handbook, although I will be really soon. Do parents have the opportunity to opt out of that?
Of having their child?
Having their child in the one-to-one? Only reason I ask is just if we're putting the responsibility for the restitution for damages on them, are we then also saying, and by the way, your child has to take this?
Yeah. I mean, we did not provide that as an option. I certainly imagine that if a parent talked to us excessively, I don't recall any parents, Ashok, do you?
No, I mean, there in special situations there have been parents where we work with to say, you know, this isn't maybe the appropriate tool for your child, and we made special arrangements for that particular student. So it is on a per student basis. And that's why we've had some flexibility with, you know, this year as we started the new program to say, okay, we'll give you some opportunity to use it. If you damage it, we're gonna give you a one-time chance. But what we're finding is there's more damage than we expected in the first year, and so we'd like to kind of begin to tighten that down a little bit. So we're looking at options to control those costs.
The one thing I would want to point out too is that being that the language is very similar to textbooks, we're not giving people the option to opt out of textbooks. So
yeah, and I was thinking the same thing. I mean, we're sort of approaching a day and age where the Chromebook is not that different than the textbook, mm-hmm. but the care that a child needs to use with Chromebook is really different than a history textbook. You know, if I drop a history textbook, mm-hmm. it's going to hurt my foot, but that's about it. That's the place. I mean, I think this should be something that becomes part of generally accepted practice, because this is where we are, right? I mean, we're one-to-one in the middle school, we're one-to-one in the high mm-hmm. school. It's only going to continue to increase, but I just was curious about as we make that transition, because it is different than a textbook.
Yeah, and the other thing I would say, I've had a couple conversations with parents, and you know, the way that the Chromebook has been set up in the school with the filtering and all those pieces, it's, you know, my argument has been, and so far successfully, is that the Chromebook is the right tool because that's what everybody's using. That's how we're using the Google apps. And so understand that some people have MacBooks at home or other different devices, but the way that teachers are communicating, the Chromebook tends to work the best.
Yeah. And you do teach them how to care for them and expectations and...
We do. In our digital literacy course that we have, we cover, you know, care both physically to the device, but also care for the things that you're putting online.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. And we'll have more kind of data about, for example, the number of damaged machines we've had over the course of this year. You know, we can kind of report out on that and talk about maybe some next steps, you know, and looking at, you know, whether insurance is something that's viable or not. But when we originally assessed the cost of insurance and the cost of a warranty plan for each of those devices, it was hugely expensive. And when we looked at the cost analysis and looked at the individual parts to replace on a Chromebook, are very, really cheap. So that's another reason why we chose that device. It seems to be a good fit for cost and what we're trying to do with it in the classroom. But we're also looking at other changes too, physically, to the cases that we're going to be using. We currently use a sleeve for the device, and obviously the Chromebook is being used most of the time out of the sleeve, and so that's when a lot of the accidents are happening. So we're looking to get a hard protective shell for the devices that have rubberized corners and protection that are on all the time, mm-hmm. which we think will help protect the device a little better. So we're going to look at that as stage, you know, in step one in reducing damage.
I guess I would wonder, and I'm sure it would be not feasible to do going forward for the coming year, but if there would be a way for parents to opt into the insurance themselves to purchase for their child. If, say, you had a particularly clumsy 11-year-old or 12-year-old and you had concerns about that, rather than getting a bill for a couple $100 or whatever the damage would be at the end of the year, if you could pay a fee up front.
Yeah, we definitely could. Sure. We're looking at third-party companies, and we have some relationships for you know, the high school program where parents are actually coming to us and asking for advice on that. So we could reach out to that vendor to get some quotes on the insurance coverage. But just to clarify, it's quite different than the repair on a MacBook. So,
okay.
And that's one of the reasons it's a much better tool for the middle school. So, for example, a screen on a MacBook to fix might cost at most $60, where you're looking at up to $400 on a MacBook Air. Or a cracked shell is only like $2, or a hinge is like $2, where on a MacBook it's quite higher, you know, much higher. So some of these... costs that some parents have incurred this year are really maybe $6, maybe $20, so it's not huge,
but
when you look at that
then.
To actually the cost of insurance, it's not quite at a place where it makes sense yet, but that's why I think we have to look at the total numbers this year and see if that's an added value for parents.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd be happy to report out on that once we have those numbers.
Any other questions on the handbook changes?
Good.
Okay. So at this point in time, I would seek a motion to approve the changes to the middle school handbook as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. Thank you, Mr. Keller.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Good night, Mr. Keller.
Good night.
Thank you.
Okay, and next on our agenda is the high school stateside overnight intent to travel recommendation. Dr. McLeod.
So these are both intents, and as we know, they basically are giving us the information with the expectation that more detail would come with the final recommendation. Welcome, Mr. Dumas.
It's nice to be here. Wearing the colors.
I see you're sporting the color. That's good. So the first would be for the varsity field hockey trip. This is a trip that they've taken for the past couple of years, I want to say. It's early in September, and it includes leaving on a Friday. It's over a weekend. And the second is Model UN, again, something that we've been participating in ever since I've been here.
to Brown University, and that will take place November the 11th through the 13th. The information for the intent is in your packet with the backup information. These are, because these are things that we've done, had in the past, because I know that we talked at length about where they were staying, and we wanted to make sure that we're staying in hotels and not in private homes. I don't see anything, any reason, and I'm recommending that the intent be approved for both of these trips.
Does anyone have any questions? All right. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the intent to travel requests for the varsity field hockey team to Dennis Yarmouth High School, September 9th through September 10th, 2016, as well as the Model UN to Brown University, Rhode Island, November 11th through November 13th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, it's unanimous and so carries. All right, our next item is capital project article warrant number 16-072 in the amount of $10,235.83. Mr. Dumas.
So we have 8 invoices on this warrant. 5 of them are from DCM Controls related to the school safety and security project that was appropriated in May of 2015. We have 1 invoice, the final invoice for MV Electrical contractors for the middle school fire alarm project. That was also appropriated in May of 2015. We have 1 invoice from Permaline Corp related to the school safety and security project for May 15. And also from May 15 is an invoice from Signet for the school safety and security project. Total of $10,235.83, and the superintendent and I recommend that these items be approved for payment by the school committee.
Any questions on the motion or on the warrant itself? Okay. At this time, I'd seek a motion to approve the payment of warrant number 16-072 in the amount of $10,235.83 to the vendors as outlined in the warrant.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
It's unanimous. Thank yes. You. And so carries. Sorry, I always forget to say yes.
Mr. Ghosh, could you come back up? Thank you.
All right. We're on to the award of contracts for the high school one-to-one laptops and other Apple equipment. Mr. Dumas and Mr. Ghosh.
Yeah, there's actually 2 bids that were done. They're separate. The first is for the one-to-one laptop initiative. This is the 5th year of the initiative. This is going to cover next year's 9th graders. We put it out to bid. We indicated to vendors that we thought we'd need 210 units approximately. The final number will be determined by the participants, i.e. the students and their families. So, as has happened several times in the past, there was only 1 bid. It came from Apple. Guess what? We're buying Apple equipment. So, the technical details are available on the bid sheet that you have. Payments will be made to Apple on August 1st of 16, 17, 18, and 19, and then there's a $1 per unit buyout at the end of the lease. So the administration recommends that the school committee approve the bid received from Apple for the MacBooks at unit costs of $1,078 to be paid for via a 3-year lease. As you can see, it's 4 payments. Funding will come from payments into the one-to-one laptop initiative revolving account by students and their families.
Does anyone have any questions or discussion on the motion or the materials that were provided?
So, I have 1 question that's probably I guess my question. So we're in year 5. So at what point, do we do an assessment on the devices? So I know when we launched this program, there was a fair amount of debate, at least from community level, about why MacBooks. So So I'm just curious, like, is there a time frame in which we want to take a step back and say, is this, should we be sticking with these machines?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's probably about time. I think to do an overall assessment of the device, I think I would just kind of pause and just issue a word of caution as far as big sweeping changes to a program because of the sheer amount of management and work that goes into managing multiple devices. So let's say we decide to go out to bid and people are interested in other PC or tablet type devices. The challenge with that is then dealing with and managing multiple vendors, which is quite a bit of work. So I'm definitely open to discussing opportunities for change with the community, with parents, to see if there's other devices that our parents are more interested in having. But I think the benefit of the program now is that parents do have that choice, right? So there really is no difference if they bring their own device, if they go out and purchase their own device, or if they decide to lease through the district. So a lot of parents do exercise that option, and it's still probably 70-30% mix of students bringing their own versus students leasing from us. So there are some options built in the program, but yeah, I think it is time to take a look at that, and I'm open to discussing it more.
And just to build on, so I wouldn't say necessarily that I mean, the community is an important voice in that, but I really mean from an educational and a model perspective, and I recognize that change with the infrastructure we have would not be easy or overnight, but obviously with technology changing as rapidly as it is, you know, we wouldn't have thought 4 or 5 years ago that we'd be looking at as many different smartphone options other than the iPhone as we are, and you know that happens over time. So just so we can stay ahead of anything like that.
Yeah, I agree.
That's my question.
One question I had for Mr. Dumas, maybe you remember. I don't remember whether or not this is like, is the price comparable to what we've been paying in the past, or is it a large increase? Or
no, I think it's very much in the ballpark. From last year.
I can give you a couple of comparatives. I mean, there aren't sweeping changes in the cost. Obviously, there's a couple of factors that affect cost, you know, the volume, the number of machines that we purchase, the technical specs of the machine, which haven't changed over time. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, for example, the overall cost for the machines that we purchased last year were around $1,087 per unit plus AppleCare, whereas this year, the total cost without tax is $1,068.63. So there's a little bit of a reduction. And we also got a little bump in specs. So last year, for example, the models had 4 gigs of RAM for memory. This year they have 6 gigs of RAM. So we're saving a little bit per year with the cost, and we got a little bit of an upgrade. So there wasn't sweeping change, but there was a little bit of a decrease.
Great, mm-hmm. Thank you.
And I just have a question about the buyout. So for this class,
senior group.
So the seniors, the graduating seniors, which are the first class in the program, their buyout option was different, right? Is that correct? So the rest of them have their final last payment is more than a dollar.
Correct. The former technology director charged the sales tax as payments were made.
Right.
When Ashok took over, the sales tax didn't get charged until the end.
Okay.
So I believe you said your plan now is to charge it as we go.
Yeah.
So
I mean,
there's,
I think,
less confusion.
So this will be switching back to the $1 buyout, right, for this incoming class.
Yeah. So it'd be nice just to have those kind of four payments, so mm-hmm. that there is no payment the senior year.
Okay.
It takes the pressure off parents, obviously. Right. It's less payment collection.
Right.
Work for us mm-hmm. to do on right. that side, and so I think it makes much more sense to do it that way.
Yeah. And then this is a curiosity question, not sure. related to voting on this, but just did you have anyone return them?
Yeah, we did, for multiple reasons. So we had about eight students that returned the devices from the senior class.
Yeah.
For probably two or so reasons. You know, primarily changes in family dynamics or financial issues, or maybe some parents actually who had moved out of district prior transferred out. So those are two of the mm-hmm. reasons, but not too many devices.
So pretty high retention rate.
Yeah.
Good.
And then what happens with those devices?
The goal right now is to retain those and use those as loaner devices.
Okay.
So we did budget for a pool of money to really write off, I guess, in a way, any bad debt that we might have had from the program. So those aid, if there was, the last payments, for example, weren't made, we would use some of the money to pay those and use those in-house. So it's cheaper for us to retain those and buy those out, sure, and use them as loaners than buying new ones. So that's the plan for those eight.
Great, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Any more questions? We're all set. Okay, at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the contract awards. I'm just sorry, I'm struggling a little bit with our grammar here, but the contract awards for the lease of Apple equipment to Apple Computer for the one-to-one program in the amount of $54,790.51 per year for 3 years, and other Apple equipment for the district in the amount of $129,196.12 per year for 3 years.
Excuse me.
Did I go ahead?
Madam Chair, we probably should take separate
I was wondering about that, because when motions, I read them, they're different.
And it would be important that rather than saying the $53,000, that we simply approve the lease of the one-to-one laptops for a price of $1,078 plus interest each, because we really don't know how many units we're going to need.
All right. Well, let me work off of your document,
okay,
Mr. Dumas. And let's scratch that prior seeking of a motion. And the new motion I'm seeking is for the school committee to approve the bid received from Apple Inc. for MacBooks as detailed in the agenda materials at the unit cost of $1,078 to be paid via a 3-year lease.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Kavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. And Mr. Dumas.
Sure. The next one will be simpler because we know what we're going to be spending. So we can say $196.12 for a 3-year lease. So what we have there is the FY17 budget includes funding to initiate a new 3-year lease for elementary teacher laptops and a variety of other equipment for the district. Again, we put it out to bid. Apple was the only bidder, and the details are in your packet. This is a fixed number of various equipment. If anybody has questions about the details, obviously Mr. Gosch is here.
Any questions amongst committee members? No? Okay. So at this time, I would seek a motion to approve, give me a second on this one, the awarding of the contract of the lease of other Apple equipment in the district in the amount of $129,196.12 per year for 3 years.
So moved.
Second.
All right, motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. All right. And we're moving on to the award of student information systems contract. Mr. Dumas.
Okay. The May 2016 annual town meeting appropriated $100,000 for the purchase and installation of a new student information system to replace IPAS. For your information, our annual operating budget also includes about $75,000 for costs that will be incorporated into the annual subscription cost of the new student information system, which from now on I'm going to call the SIS. For those at home, the SIS system manages student enrollment, grades, attendance, discipline, course scheduling, emergency communication, and probably everything else. So in this case here, rather than using an invitation to bid process, we used what's called the request for proposals process, or RFP. State procurement guidelines allow you to use an RFP process where you don't want to just consider price as the sole factor in making your decision as to what's best for the school system. Rather than price, you look at value. So in this case here, what we did is through the technology department, Ashok and his folks, we actually invited vendors in to make presentations to several user groups a couple of months ago. User groups included parents, teachers, administrators. And following that, Ashok put together a review team to develop evaluation criteria that we would use to rank the proposals. That included Ashok, Linda Henderson, administrators, teachers, etc. Multiple criteria items were incorporated into the formal RFP documents. They were publicly advertised, distributed to vendors in early May. At the deadline, we'd received three proposals. So the price proposals were not opened until the review team had finished ranking their technical proposals. In fact, the price proposals were locked up in a safe while I was on vacation. And when I returned from vacation, I met with Ashok to get the rankings, and the highest ranked, there were two of the proposals, one from Power School and one from Infinite Campus, were considered to be highly advantageous based upon the criteria. And the group conducted further review of their products and references. And the remaining proposal from Skyward was judged to be not advantageous. So after deliberation, despite the fact that Power School system does not include a premium robocall feature, the team agreed that Power School's SIS is still the best overall product for Hopkinton. A premium robocall product can easily be integrated with Power School at a cost that is expected to be less than or equal to the difference between the two top proposes. You can see the three top proposes. Power School happened to be the lowest price, as I mentioned, $200,462.20 with a basic robocall feature compared to Infinite Campus and Skyward, which were higher. So the team agreed that Power School system was the preferred product. The fact that their proposal is the lowest price makes the decision a very easy one. We recommend that the school committee award a contract for a student information system to Power School of Folsom, California at a cost of $200,462.20 to be funded by Article 13 of the May 2016 annual town meeting and the system-wide technology contracted services account. You'll note that on the agenda it says $202,000. The $200,000 is the correct number. So if anybody has any questions, you can ask Ashok.
Does anyone have questions?
It was a short process.
Yeah. I do have a couple of questions. I assume this also includes support. I just am thinking back to the disaster of Munis, right? So there's customer service and support and all of that that you feel is adequate to.
That's correct. This does include a combination of training module. You know, so obviously some on-site training, web-based training, and actually some pre-built videos and things that can be viewed by teachers. So obviously we're going to come out with a full-on implementation plan and discussion with the community about this migration. So this is really just the beginning, but there's definitely funds for training.
Okay. And then my final question is, it seems like there's about $25,000 that wasn't accounted for in either between the capital the capital article or the operating budget. So I'm just...
Well, that's a good question. On the attachment, the last items, there's three. It's a three-year subscription, so some of this money is not going to be spent until future years.
Okay,
and
so we
already,
can budget
it's
for
already
that.
Factored into the budgets.
Okay. Okay. Great, thank you.
So I have a more, it's a more of a broad brush question in terms of the contracts for all of these, but who reviews our contracts for these? I mean, the hair on the back of my neck is up a little bit when we're talking about software as a service, because I have particular experience in that area of contracting. So I just wonder, you know, how we're reviewing those, and if we're looking at particular areas, like how do we get out of the contract if it's not going well, if they're not providing us the service, if it doesn't support the needs that we really anticipated, and you know, our warranty obligations, their warranty obligations, all those things. I'm just wondering who reviews all that.
That's a good question, and that's not something we've really thought about. But we can certainly have a conversation with either district council or town council about reviewing the contract that Power School will give to us to sign. So before we, you know, make those final steps and sign a contract, we'll make sure that we're very comfortable with it, with those aspects.
Yeah,
good point.
Especially because with software as a service especially, and I don't know if they're storing on the cloud or where they're doing their storage, but information security measures and making sure that they have adequate security measures and that they're auditing those security measures are really important. And especially because the sensitive information that is going to be stored mm-hmm. there when you talk about disciplinary actions and things of that nature, I just really would highly encourage us to look into that because some of the contracts can be very onerous and very one-sided depending on how big the company is. Some of the smaller companies aren't sophisticated and don't have in-house counsel to really have great contracts in place, and so that information is just missing. And then you don't have anything to fall back on the contract. So just from an industry person who's read it, I would encourage you to seek that counsel on these types of contracts because there's some security measures there you should be concerned about.
Thank you for bringing
that's
up. And for your information, unlike IPASS, which is sort of a, I'll call it a mom and pop type database, Power School is one of the leaders in the country.
Yeah, so, yeah, I see they're based out of California. Yeah. They're probably one of the larger ones.
They are the largest.
Yeah.
Provider of
if it wasn't a conflict of interest for me to review it for you, I would obviously do it, but obviously that's a problem for me to do that for you, but I just would encourage you to have that second set of eyes on there.
Okay. Thank you for
and just think
out.
About those areas when you're reading it because you'll see where there's gaps. So
thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Then at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the SIS contract award to Power School of Folsom, California at a cost of $200,462.20 to be funded by Article Number 13 of the May 2016 Annual Town Meeting and the System-Wide Technology Contracted Services Account.
So moved.
Second. Motion by Ms. Cavanaugh, seconded by Ms. Burton. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. And now we can move on to expend and year-end balances. And thank you.
Actually, Madam Chairman, if we could skip to the next, skip over this one for a sec.
Yeah.
Because Ashok was actively involved in the next two procurements as well.
Oh, okay. Does anyone have any objection to skipping the? Okay, great. So then, no problem. We will move on to letter H, the award of the high and middle school telescopic bleachers contract.
All right,
go ahead, Mr. Dumas.
You want to take that one on the show?
Sure.
Okay. Here's the write-up.
Yeah. So May 2016 annual town meeting appropriated $85,000 for the upgrade and repairs for the high school and middle school bleachers. This will motorize the existing bleachers and eliminate the use of old manual mule, which is putting employees at risk and causing damage to the existing bleachers, and will bring the current bleachers up to code. To identify a vendor that will result in the best outcome for Hopkins Public Schools, the request for proposals method of procurement was employed. The bid was published on 5/18/2016 on the Central Registry. And a legal notice was placed in the local newspaper and all bid guidelines were followed. There was a single bid from Hussey Seating Company for $66,560. Hussey Seating has done several projects for the district and has done good work. After successfully reviewing the proposal from Hussey Seating Company, we recommend the school committee award a contract for the high school and middle school bleachers upgrades and repairs to Hussey Seating Company at a cost of $66,560 to be funded by Article Number 13 of May 2016 Annual Town Meeting. This will leave a balance in the appropriation for the electrical work that also will be required to complete the work.
Anyone have any questions or comments? Mr. Dumas, I have just a quick question.
Sure.
Like money-wise, if we, with the electrical work, don't utilize the entire appropriation, it's not that we've received the $85,000 yet, it's just that will just stay with the town.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Does anyone else have any? Okay. Then at this time, now I gotta get in my right area of the document. You can tell it's getting late. I would seek a motion to approve the contract award for the telescopic bleachers to Hussey Seating Company in the amount of $66,560.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. Moving on to the next one as well, Mr. Dumas, right? The award of asphalt patch and berm repairs contract.
That's correct. I'd just like to point out there was a typo in the memo, so I do have an updated memo. I'd like to pass those out. Yeah, maybe.
Thank you.
I'm hearing you.
You good?
Yeah, I'm good.
Multiple copies.
Yeah.
So the May 2016 annual town meeting approved $15,000 be the school department's budget for asphalt patching and berm repair of various parking lots throughout the Hopkinton School District. To identify a vendor that would result in the best outcome for Hopkinton Public Schools, the request for proposals method of procurement was employed. The bid was published on 5/25/2016 in the Central Registry, and legal notice was placed in the local newspaper, and all bid guidelines were followed. The price proposals in ranked order were as follows. Ellingwood Construction for $14,500, J.H. Lynch & Son for $16,350, and Manny Paving and Contractors, Inc. for $18,400. After successfully reviewing the proposal and references from Ellingwood Construction, we recommend the school committee award a contract for the asphalt patching and berm repairs for various parking lots to Ellingwood Construction at a cost of $14,500 from the extraordinary maintenance account.
Is there any questions or discussion from the committee?
I just have one quick question. Sure. Is this the high school? This isn't the... is any of this at the high school, middle school?
No, the primary work that will be done by the contractor will be taking place at the Hopkins School and at Elmwood School, where there's some temporary resurfacing and gravel prep work last year to allow some of the buses to make some of the loops, both at Elmwood and where the new preschool kind of entry is, and then in the loop around Hopkins. Okay. So those, the primary work will be the paving of those graveled spots. The leftover work will be repairing some of the berms that have been kind of corroded. Some of that berm work will take place around the high school parking lots.
Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to make sure because I remember the HCA had to dig up the high school and middle school parking lot to run the pipe or something that we had to
approve.
So just, I wanted to make sure we weren't paying for
that.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Not that I don't think they're nice people, but...
I don't believe there was any other questions, but you can, did you have a comment?
Yeah, my comment was just that I wanted to point out to the school committee, as you know, Mr. Ghosh is taking on the responsibility for overseeing buildings and grounds. And I think the fact that these are on the agenda are already an example of the oversight that he's bringing to having the things in place so that we can move forward in a timely fashion with these initiatives, these projects. Because I think it was all of a sudden we weren't having another meeting until July the 7th. And so I just wanted to thank you, Ashok, and I know you're working very closely with Mr. Rogers and with Lisa Cardi to have a project overview and a timeline so that everything doesn't, you know, wait till the end of the summer. So it was just a comment.
Great. Thank you. All right, so at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the contract award for asphalt patch and berm repair to various parking lots within the district to Ellingwood Construction in the amount of $14,500.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. Thank you so much, Mr. Ghosh.
Thank you.
And you're welcome to stay for the ratification because I know you've been also on the negotiating team.
I didn't realize that.
If you want to do that
just
one too.
Now.
Yeah, sure.
Just when you thought you were.
I know, huh?
We'll ask you to stay for something else.
All right. So for our, you know, actually, you never know how to do these votes to ratify. So we're looking at the vote to ratify the MOU with the custodians. This was the request and recommendation of the superintendent that the school committee vote to ratify the MOU with the custodians, Local 335, Council 93. And right now I would seek a motion to approve the vote to ratify the MOU with the custodians, Local 335, Council 93.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh, and we need to take a roll call vote. So Mrs. Birchman?
Yes.
Mrs. Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Mr. Graziano?
Yes.
And I am a yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries.
Now you're off the
hook.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ghost. Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
Thank you. You too.
Okay, so our last item on the agenda, we'll jump back up to G, the request to expend year-end balances. Mr. Dumas?
Sure. Okay, I made the third quarter financial report, I think at the end of April, and we estimated we'd have a balance of around $550,000. The number will be higher than that, in particular because we had money put aside for two students whom we thought were going to be outplaced. Towards the end of the year. As it turned out, they were not. So that's going to add to that number. We'll give you a final report that will have additional end of year figures. At the time this was written, we had 10 days of labor expenses to be paid, as well as the final month of utilities, maintenance costs, which are all gonna impact the final figure. In accordance with school committee policy DBJ, we're requesting that we be allowed to expend year-end balances that will place the school department in a stronger position going forward in the next year, which already has some identified budget challenges that include tuition and transportation costs for special ed students who were outplaced or will be outplaced after the FY17 budget was submitted. Those costs are still to be determined. We do have an additional freshman going to Norfolk County next year. That additional cost is known, that's $27,500. We also have the possible and perhaps likely need for additional special ed staff due to increased special ed demands related to potential and now known move-ins. Those costs will be determined at or around the start of the school year. So at this point, we recommend approval of two actions. One is to expend approximately $260,000, which is similar to last year's number, to prepay FY17 special education tuition costs. That'll free up funds in next year's budget, and it's allowed by Mass General Laws, there are two of them, 7171D and Chapter 40-40E. Second is to expend up to $357,482 to prepay the entire FY17 except collaborative special ed transportation costs. That would also free up funds in next year's budget. That's allowed under Chapter 40, Section 40E. Now, obviously, the 260 and the 357 combined is more than the 550 that we were looking at. But that's the reason I said I request up to. I'm not going to expend money that I don't have. Now, John, you also had pointed out at the last time we talked about this that we could also make an adjustment to the circuit breaker account. That number would be around $82,000 or $83,000. So when we all get together on July 7th and we know what the final numbers are, that's still one of the possible moves that we could make. At this point, all we're really going to do is expend the 260 for the tuitions. At the last minute, I'll be able to say to accept, send me a bill for X amount of dollars. So the second part of that we can wait on.
Is the 82,000 the projected balance at the end of FY17 or the amount we're expending account in FY17?
Actually, it's neither.
Okay.
We're projecting that we'll have a balance at the end of the year of $463,000.
At the end of this year.
The maximum that we can have in that account is $545,000.
So the difference
between the two is the $82,000.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Okay.
But I guess what I was also thinking was, when I asked that question was, and this, I don't think it's something we need to actually decide at this point, is could we use it to, what's our expenditure out of circuit breaker projected next year? If you don't have that number, that's okay. But I guess what I'm getting at is, I guess I'd rather see that offset circuit breaker expenditure than offset operating budget.
Yeah,
because then it leaves that money as directed at special education.
The number for next year that we budgeted to use circuit break was $700,000. It was
okay.
Level from one year to the next.
Okay. So do you get what I mean in terms of the difference between in terms of the difference between offsetting the expenditure from circuit breaker versus just offsetting operating budget?
Well, I think it all works out the same way.
Yeah, but one's earmarked.
Yeah.
And that's why when one person personal preference is I'd rather leave that money earmarked.
Yeah.
And that's why I'd prefer to do it that way.
Sure. We can do that in other things. So.
Okay. So I jumped in there. Are we ready for questions?
Sure.
Because I have another one. So it says expend approximately $260,000.
Yeah, because you never know. I mean, like last year, I think you approved 265, maybe, and we spent 263.
Okay.
Basically, what it is you're allowed to pay up to 3 months of tuition.
Okay.
And because all the tuitions are slightly different, you're never going to come to exactly that amount of money.
So, although the motion is exact.
It should say approximately.
The recommended motion doesn't say approximately, but
I guess the question though would be why isn't that one also up to versus approximately?
Well, it could be 262.
What's your tolerance level though? I mean, that's the question.
You make that call.
And I don't know how to craft the motion this way, but I think as I've stated in previous years, from a year-end balance perspective, I haven't said it's previous years because I think this is the first year we've done the except collaborative special ed transportation, which I think is a great use for it. These are basically the only two places where I think we are in a good position to expend year-end balances. Mm-hmm. So, I don't have a big problem with a motion that doesn't lock us into a number as long as it stays within these two places, because we're locked in by law, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's three months of special ed tuition, whatever that amounts to, and it's whatever the bill is from except.
Yeah, in past years, mm-hmm. we've come to the committee and we've said that we wanted to expend it on copy machines.
Right, and that's...
We're not talking about that. We're just talking about special education.
And if I could add, I think this is the one area in any district, and you know from having us come to you with unexpected expenses, where it's really difficult to budget
correctly.
I feel that it is very appropriate because it's those unexpected that we haven't been able to budget for expenses that this allows us a little bit of a comfort zone, and I feel it's absolutely legitimate to be able to make those transfers.
So I don't want to jump in if other people still have questions. I just had a quick question on, obviously you're saying approximately 260. You have a round number there, but the except collaborative one is pretty specific. So we already know that number?
Yeah. We do.
Okay.
Yeah. It's an assessment based upon our FY16 ridership. Uh-huh. That's how we pay the FY17 bill. So that one's a specific.
And so that one was written as up to because of the fact that our projected balance is at 550, but when you add up those two, it's a little higher. So if we end up having more, you would pay the full bill.
Uh-huh. Yeah, see, it's easier for me to call the finance director at Accept and say, Bill, would you please send me a bill for whatever I have left? It may not be the 357, it may be less.
Right, okay. So
it's harder to do that with 20
numbers.
Different special education vendors.
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess the the final question really is whether or not we need to amend in regards to the 260, because I'm a little confused after John spoke whether or not there's concern there or not concern there, so I'm not.
I don't have, so from, you're asking if I have concern, or?
Well, the way that, yeah, the way that you raised it, so I'm just, it's not that I'm just trying to understand the concern and where we want to be in terms of, or if there is no concern, then that's fine. But
I don't have concern as long as it's within these two buckets. I mean, I could see crafting a motion that basically would say that we're authorizing the expenditure of year-end balances to prepay FY special education tuitions, you know, as allowed by those MGLs is going to give us our dollar limit, right?
Yeah.
Because it's
yeah.
3 months. And then also expend up to $357,000 for that FY7. So it's essentially, we're paying the 3 months of prepaying special ed tuition, or whatever that costs, we're paying that 3 months, and then whatever's left over, we're putting into the Accept Collaborative.
Yep.
That, so I'm comfortable with that, if that's what the request is.
I see, that is. Okay.
Ultimately, when you sign the warrant on July 7th,
yeah.
The next warrant, you are giving approval to those expenditures. And,
yeah.
And that's the key. The school committee has to approve
the motion tonight is to give yeah. you the authorization
right.
to create the warrant.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That right. I don't have any concern. I just got confused mm-hmm. a little bit as we were talking about this second piece that you just stated explained it to me much better, and the fact that there is that legal requirement there is fine. It's just now how do we want to, we need to amend the motion as it's written in the agenda materials because it's not.
Could I make a recommendation?
Absolutely.
It can be very, very vague. Authorize the administration to expend year-end balances in accordance with the memorandum dated June 10th or June 16th, period. And then you have all of that covered.
So
I think that what would actually be a better option would be to authorize the expenditures of year-end balances in accordance with Mass General Laws Chapter 71D and Chapter 40-40E, and then in addition, and to prepay the FY17 Accept Collaborative Special Education Transportation
and tuitions, and FY17
yeah.
special
yeah.
education tuitions. If you keep it vague like that without the number, does that do it?
I think what you're getting, so a motion to authorize the administration to expend year-end balances to prepay FY17 special education tuitions.
Yes.
As allowed under Mass General Law 71-71D, Chapter 40-40E. Yeah, is that okay?
And FY
the
remain
and then
collect.
The and then the remainder
yes.
to be used to. Okay, so
mm-hmm.
can we take a shot at the motion?
Yeah,
please do.
Okay, I move to authorize the district to expend year-end balances to prepay FY17 special education tuitions as allowed by Mass General Laws Chapter 71-71D and Chapter 40-40E. And expend any remaining year-end balances to prepay FY17 Accept Collaborative Special Education Transportation costs as allowed by Mass General Law Chapter 40-40E.
Perfect.
Does that work for everybody?
Perfect.
Second. Okay, motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries.
So we'll use that as a template for next year. That's good.
Well, again, because we're so much more about
yeah.
the categories.
I know.
That I think that fits.
Yeah, thank you. That was
thank
good.
You, Mr. Dumas.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dumas.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Dumas, although, you know, we do have to acknowledge that he did go to Italy.
Right.
Yeah.
And so we
came
can't
back.
We can't be feeling sorry for him, but he did come back from vacation, and he worked, he did all of this, like, in half a day. I mean, I know you must have been had some things in place before you left,
okay.
but thank you for having all of that in place for tonight's meeting, because
no
I know there were some switches at the last minute.
There were.
Yes.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I'm just here for the warrants now.
So old business is next, and there is no old business. And then we have our second opportunity for public comment, which there's nobody in the audience. So we will move on to items by consensus. Dr. McLeod.
There are a lot. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve the operating budget and other funds warrant number 16-070 in the amount of $707,093.40. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve the Elmwood School Student Activities Warrant Number 16-073 in the amount of $4,048. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve the High School Student Activities Warrant Number 16-074 in the amount of $60,800.02. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve the minutes of the regular school committee meetings of March 10, 2016, April 7, 2016, April 28, 2016, as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve the minutes of the special school committee meetings of February 3, 2016, and June 2, 2016, as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $600 from MSSAA to be placed in the high school gift account as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $592.10 from Target's Take Charge of Education fundraiser program to be placed in the Elmwood School gift account as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $332.31 from Target's Take Charge of Education fundraiser program to be placed in the middle school gift account as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $551.60 from Box Tops for Education and $400 and $227.49 from Target's Take Charge of Education fundraiser programs to be placed in the Hopkins School gift account as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to accept a gift from the senior class presentation of four high top tables and 16 chairs valued at $3,400 for use outside the library entrance.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
It's unanimous and so carries. And at this time, I would seek a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman, seconded by Ms. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
It's unanimous and so carries. And our next meeting is on July 7th. Next regular scheduled meeting is on July 7th, 2016 at 7 p.m. in the high school, or in the middle school library. And then we also have two summer meetings scheduled for July 21st and August 18th, which will be at the administration building at 4 o'clock. Thank you and good night.
2 minutes off.